After a two-week hiatus on vacation, AOA Podcast is back. Frankie C, it is good to see you, my man.
Good to see you. I can't believe it. We're back. 2 weeks. That's the longest we've been gone for, right?
Very much so. And can I say this? And I don't want to get too forward or get too excited, but back and better than ever, may I say.
That's a lot to live up to.
You look like $1 million. I got a little tan going. I think we're doing all right.
Hope you're feeling all right. I know you're a little under the weather.
Well, I'm going to die soon, but that's besides the point. We'll get to it after we get to all the topics on the episode. Epstein and Leon back in the news. We've got a Suits conspiracy theory, my friend. Is COVID returning?
COVID? Yes. Like Suits conspiracy, as in the TV show?
As in the TV show, yes.
Okay.
I've got some astounding numbers for you that you're not going to believe. Yevgeny Prigozhin, this was the Wagner German general that led the revolution for about 45 minutes or so. He's dead.
Yeah.
We found that out while we were away.
Last very long.
Some tech giants are starting a city in America. No big deal. Nothing to look at here.
Yeah.
Barbie continues to just slay at the box office. Mm. Elton John got hospitalized. We're going to talk about vacation and weird food combinations. All that and more on this episode, my friend. Are you ready?
I can't wait.
Well, then let's go.
You have been better, I have to say.
Nothing to see here.
What is going on with you? You went to the doctor.
I've been sick for a month.
For a month? It's been, yeah. Since before we went on vacation.
Way before. We missed a couple episodes before vacation, I feel.
Yeah, that is true. And you sound, I don't want to say worse, but do you feel better? I mean, your voices come and go, but do you feel?
Not really.
Not really.
You can't take on Jeffrey Epstein the way you and I have without somebody in the deep state trying to take out one of us. I'm just happy it's me and not you. I'd feel responsible.
Me too. If we're being honest. Okay. That's it. I don't know how long this episode's going to be because Anthony's sounding better before. I don't know what's happening.
45 minutes at least. It's going to be as long as the Russian Revolution from Prigozhin beginning in there.
We had hopes. There were some hopes there. And then we'll get to that, I guess.
Yeah, we will, big man. Yeah, we will. Hello to everybody in the live chat. It's so glad to have everybody back.
Welcome back, everyone.
Credit Paul with this first story here. He had it. The Senate Finance Committee is demanding answers from Leon Black. Anytime anybody is demanding answers from a Epstein consort, I'm excited about it. There is a $1 billion art collection that Epstein helped Leon Black procure. The committee wants details on a $158 million payment to Epstein for an art partnership that he created for Leon Black. And a 16-page letter was sent from U.S. Senator Ron Wyden, chairman of the Senate Finance Committee, to Leon Black late last month. The committee is investigating Black's financial dealings with Epstein, and they want some answers as to what is going on and where all this money came from and what it was used for, which is great because, you know, he died and then the Ghislaine thing, and we talked all about it, but the truth of the matter is, there's a lot more people out there. There's still a lot of money out there. And it's great that this is being fully vetted and investigated. And let's be honest, like this Leon Black shouldn't be allowed to just go free. It's just not right.
Yeah, we got to see. Because once the top is taken out, removed, eliminated, however it happens, the rest, everybody else underneath is kind of exposed. So once Jeffrey Epstein was arrested and jailed, that kind of lit a fire to get everybody underneath him. And now that Epstein's gone, there's nobody to take the hits anymore, I feel, right? So now everybody underneath is going to start getting, the comeuppance, and everybody's just going to start falling. Love it.
I love that word, comeuppance. That's my favorite.
It's such a, it is a weird word.
It's a great
like
word.
A combination though. Of like two or three words.
Yeah. We talked about this, though, the $158 million payment that Black made to Epstein for services related to a variety of tax and estate planning matters. In particular, the committee is seeking information on Epstein's participation in structuring trusts and other complex transactions designed to avoid federal gift and estate taxes on as much as $2 billion in wealth that Black has transferred to his children.
$2 billion.
Mm-hmm.
That's no chump change.
Yeah, because that's what they do. They get into these weird little, they buy property, they buy art, they buy all this shit, you know, to kind of make it, to try and avoid things and make it seem less worse and not that it's a straight money going. And it's shady shit. It's all shady shit.
It's all trying to cover it up, where the money come from. It's like, it's a complicated way of laundering, it feels like. They get all this money and then they have to filter it through things to make it look legit.
Yeah.
So
sucks.
They have to. So the people, I guess, the government now has to unravel all of that and see where it all started, and that's where we are.
I'm glad somebody's doing it, though. That's nice, because it's an easy thing to be forgotten. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's a web, and it gets overly complicated. And to start at the end and work backwards, that's no easy task, I'm sure.
Diane, yay, we're back. Miss Justice, and they're back. Aussie Annie is so very excited. Sarah,
I'm excited to hear from you guys again.
Yeah, it's so great to see everybody. Don't forget to select all messages if you're watching on YouTube, because YouTube hides some messages for some reason.
Yeah, it's weird. All messages, or like there's another feature. Just make sure it's all messages.
Yes.
Like top messages, I think, is another one. But yeah, all messages, you get them all in order. Paul says, what happens in Florida spreads to Long Island. Thanks for bringing back whatever the hell. But you had this before you went to Florida.
Yeah, I gave it to Florida a little bit, I think. Spread it around there. Right. Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Happy Power Ranger Day to you, Frank. I didn't know that. It's
Power Ranger Day?
Yeah, I guess so. That's according to Don.
I thought it was Merry Power Ranger Day. Is it not Merry?
Maybe it is. I don't know.
All right. Happy Power Ranger. Not sure. Happy Power Ranger Day to you as well.
We lost the great Bob Barker while we were gone.
We did. And Arlene Sorkin. She died young. That was not cool.
It was Arlene Sorkin.
She played Harley Quinn in the animated Batman alongside Mark Hamill's Joker. She was also Little Shop of Horrors. She was Audrey, the love interest, the woman. She was, let's see, what else was she in?
So voice person, voice actress?
Voice actress, but then she was in that, and Little Shop of Horrors, the movie with Rick Moranis.
Any relation to Aaron?
I don't know. Good question. Not sure of that.
That's what
she was also co-host of, do you remember back in the day when Dave Coulier hosted America's Funniest People?
Oh, vaguely.
She was the co-host.
It was on like right after America's Funniest Videos, right? It was like when they were trying to capitalize.
Bob Saget's thing, and then they had like a half hour or
something. Oh.
She was the co-host.
Oh, that's sad.
Dave Coulier. Yeah. She was young. She was sick, though.
But I think Rhoda's trying to tell me that I sound like shit. You're well aware of that, yeah.
Yep. We know, and it's...
I'm worried.
Dealing with it.
I'm worried that I might sound like this forever. Like, what if that's the thing? Like, what if this is the way it's going to be forever?
It's not... I mean, as long as you're not in pain and you're not coughing up a lung and you're healthy, if you sound a little raspy from now on, you know, you can deal with that.
I don't know. I was always known for my silky smooth
hair
voice.
Oh, okay. All right. The last thing I thought you were going to say was voice.
We've roughly talked about Suits a little bit, and I told you this all started for me because my parents are like, have you watched the Suits? And I go, no. And they're like, you got to watch The Suits. It's so good. I go, I don't.
They call it The Suits?
Yeah. I go, I don't want to watch Suits.
Yeah.
They're like, no, we're into The Suits. It's so great. Then I turn on Netflix, and there's the first thing that's on my Netflix is like,
oh, yeah. Suits. It's like number one on Netflix. It's constantly. It's all you see on Netflix.
Okay. According to Nelson Streaming, Suits has beaten Wednesday, achieving the second highest six-week viewership total ever. So we're talking about like a 6 week run. Okay, Wednesday, the Netflix show, was watched for just under 20.3 billion minutes in its first 6 weeks of availability when it premiered last fall. Suits has exceeded that with just over 20.3 billion minutes between June 19th and July 30th.
And this is an old show. This show ended how long ago? See, I think the whole, if you're talking conspiracy, can I jump ahead and say I think I know what the conspiracy is?
Yes.
I think it's whatever Netflix jams down your throat. As soon as you turn Netflix on, it's like, boom.
Yeah.
That's what's going to be watched. And not to mention, I mean, I know people watch Suits. It might be a good show, whatever it is, but also Meghan Markle is in it. People want to see her in it for some, the people who follow that whole thing. But yeah, it's an old show. I don't know how many seasons it is, but Seinfeld is up there. You don't see, unless you've watched Seinfeld and it shows up on your just watched thing or continue watching thread, it's not jammed down your throat. Like, I feel like if they put that as the first thing and that was the cover of Netflix as soon as you sign in, they probably have the viewership would be in the billions like that too.
But you're right. You're talking about it's not even arguably the greatest sitcom of all time is Seinfeld.
Yeah.
And the amount of people who watch Seinfeld, also Friends was big. The Office was big on Netflix. All these shows.
Is Friends on Netflix?
It was. I think
it's on HBO now.
Yes. It got taken to HBO because it was a Warner Brothers property, but it was on Netflix before Max and HBO and all that stuff kind of started. But these were huge shows. You never heard these kinds of numbers. In fact, the only show on Netflix to do better than Suits is Stranger Things, which totaled 27.8 billion minutes watched over a six-week time period when season four debuted last summer. But I can't emphasize this enough. We're talking about a show that is created, produced, and made by Netflix. You know, like there's so much hype behind that show.
Right. And it's still running. They're not done with it. Suits is over. Suits ended a while ago.
Exactly. It's still running. It's big. It's their own property. Since House of Cards has subsided, Stranger Things has become Netflix's thing.
Yeah, it's there.
So obviously they want to push that. So I get that being there, but you're talking about a USA Network show.
You know what they should need to do? They need to buy the rights to ALF and jam that down everybody's throat and see, just to test the conspiracy theory, just to see. All right, that's not bad. Let's take a bad show. ALF was arguably really good, I thought. Let's take a bad show and put it up there and see if it gets jammed down everybody's throat and beats the records. Because I mean, I don't know if Suits is good or bad, but the conspiracy theory is telling us, right, that it's seeing these numbers because they're literally, it's the first thing you see as soon as you open up Netflix.
Well, I think that's half of the conspiracy, because I think we've had other shows in that prime spot, like the first thing you see, but haven't done these numbers. So that's what's missing here, what I can't put my finger on. Because it can't be that good of a show. And not that I don't love My Parents, but the big show that they were watching before The Suits was some cowboy romance show that was produced in Canada. They're like, you got to see the show. It's so good. So I go, all right, put it on. They put it on. I don't know. It was some, what's this? What's the Canada? CBC? I think it was the CBC. It was all about this ranch and this fan. It was terrible. No, it was not Yellowstone. No, I don't know what the name of it was. It was awful. But they loved that show. That's not a critique of My Parents. There's plenty of shows that I watch that are just shitty and terrible that I'm like just so into. I'm like, oh, this is great. Like Ballers. What a bad show. But I like that show. Ballers was great for everybody who couldn't get over Entourage being finished. You're like, fuck it. We'll just watch Ballers.
Entourage. I couldn't get into that show.
Oh, Entourage. I love it.
Sucked.
I'm watching it again. You know what's weird about Entourage? The amount of stuff that Entourage predicted, it's kind of ridiculous.
What do you mean?
Like in Entourage, the first big movie that Vince gets is Aquaman. There's been two Aquamans, and he's been in all the other movies, right? But this was when Spider-Man was a hit. This was pre. Wait, I don't even know if the Batman's, Christopher Nolan Batman's, had come out yet.
Yeah, but what is that? They predicted what? That Aquaman came out?
That Aquaman would be a movie. This was definitely pre Iron Man.
That's easy though. That's
Aquaman.
Yeah, you could. You know, I predict that.
I don't think so.
I'll make a prediction right now. You pick any superhero.
No, but I mean, it was kind of like this far-fetched thing that this kid would get this role as Aquaman, and now Aquaman is a movie. Okay. Also,
go ahead.
Vince gets a role playing Ferrari. Was it Enzo Ferrari? I think is his name.
I don't know.
Adam Driver. They just wrapped up the thing. It's going to be his next movie. He plays Enzo Ferrari in a movie. You know, it's kind of weird.
Did he predict? Did they predict it, or did it come from that?
What do you mean?
Like, did the idea for that come from
Entourage?
Entourage.
I mean, I don't know, but that's the point. Entourage. A lot of the things that were done in Entourage have become reality.
Make it a good show. I mean, Simpsons predicts a lot of things, and it's a great show. But Entourage, yeah, predicts some stuff, but it's still garbage. See, the difference is, I think I know why you like that show. It has all the sociopaths of like a Sopranos and like a Godfather and all this stuff, but there's no mob. It's just a bunch of people that are full of themselves. Walking around Hollywood. Am I hitting the mark there?
No, I don't think so.
Aren't they all like, because I tried to get into it and I'm like, these people are insufferable. All the people on that show are just, I don't know. I couldn't take it. I just couldn't watch it.
I don't know if sociopaths is the right word.
Maybe not sociopath, but
narcissists?
Narcissists. Thank you. That's a better word. Yes.
Yeah.
Sociopath is, yeah, no.
No, I'll say what I like about that show. I always like behind the scenes Hollywood stuff. I always love that. Like if you give me anything of Hollywood in the 1930s and 40s, fucking watch it.
I'm in. Yeah, that sounds fine to me. It's just the characters in that show. I just couldn't get.
But I also do love the camaraderie.
Kevin Connelly, I can't watch Kevin Connelly.
Oh, I love Kevin Connelly.
For more than 30 seconds. I can't do it.
I love the camaraderie of all the guys. That always reminded me of like our little pal.
That's probably why I couldn't watch it. So Raven says The Ranch. Was that the show?
It Raven, bless your heart. It might have been The Ranch.
That might have been Sam Elliott.
No. No, it wasn't Sam. I'm telling you, there was not a known actor in this show. It was like the horses were dying, and then they were rescuing horses from the river that were. I mean, it was just fucking awful. I never rooted for a horse to die, but like 23 minutes in, I'm like, I hope this fucking horse dies. I can't stand it. And then they're transferring the horses the wrong way, so they're showing up sick. And all the family's concerned and they're talking about it. And I'm just like, I don't know. There's not even a fucking, this is what they do in Canada. Like, they're just like, let's not have a plot. Let's just have all the horses come around. They get a little sick. Then we fix them and everybody's happy. Like, that's the whole.
I gotta tell you, I didn't think there were any horse ranches in Canada. I gotta be honest. I thought,
oh yeah,
it was all reindeer and penguins or whatever the fuck.
No, Calgary, you go west in Canada. It is cowboy country over there.
There's no penguins in Canada. I know that.
There's some penguins, I think.
Are they penguins? I thought penguins were a south.
Maybe the moose ate them all. I don't know. I'm not sure.
Polar bears, moose, meese. Yeah, moose.
I don't know. Moose. Going back to the conspiracy, is other shows have been in that spot and haven't blown up this much. There has to be something there. And you made a good point about Meghan Markle. I still don't even think that's enough. I
don't even know how much she's in it, but she is. Maybe that's the thing.
Part of me.
When were these numbers? For June or July or something?
Yeah, June 19th to July 30th.
Yeah.
Six weeks, 20.3 billion minutes.
It's a lot. I mean, it could have been the Meghan Markle stuff, because wasn't there a lot of hubbub around their podcast or something at that time? Beginning of the summer.
No, I think our podcast was already done.
Yeah, I don't know. I have no concept of time anymore.
Yeah, I know, right? Isn't it? It's hard to hold on to that shit, isn't it?
I can't believe it's August. My wife pointed out July freaking crawled, and August is almost over, and I can't. It just fucking flew.
My kids were teasing me today. They're like, "What are you doing for your anniversary?" And I go, "That is a ways away. We don't have to worry about that." And then I looked and I realized, "Oh no, it's 2 days away."
Oops.
Because there's some. I don't know what happened with August, the getting sick and vacation and whatever. But it felt like we went from August 6th to August 28th. Like the whole thing just got skipped. Mm-hmm. And maybe because we weren't doing a podcast. I don't really know. But
here's my Heartland.
Fuck, it might have been Heartland.
Says Wicket 01 from Canada.
All right, I got to look this up now. Okay. I might have to call
Rhoda says it's definitely Heartland because it's like a Hallmark movie. Hallmark show movie.
No, it was
Laura, yes, saying Heartland. A lot of
it's
people say
Heartland. It's Heartland.
Nailed it. All right, now we all got to watch Heartland. Let's all watch Heartland and make it the number one freaking thing.
I think it was Heartland. I don't know. These people don't look. I don't know. It doesn't look right to me now, but maybe.
You don't recognize any of the characters?
Yeah.
You're going to have to watch it, dude.
Oh, shit. Hold on. God damn it.
No, you're not going to watch it now, are you?
No, I'm not going to watch it now. I'm going to call my mom. She's not going to remember what it is. I know it's not. Ma.
What?
What are you doing? What's all that noise?
Oh, no, we're watching TV.
Oh, okay.
How are you feeling?
I feel okay. I'm on the podcast, so don't be racist like you usually are, okay?
Why?
Well, because we don't want people to know how racist you are.
Anthony, stop. I'm not racist.
Quick question. Do you remember that show on Netflix that you guys used to love and watch all the time about the horses and the ranch?
Yeah, Heartland.
Well, Heartland. Ah, okay, so it is Heartland. Okay. I couldn't remember what it was. That's all I needed to know. All right.
Good night.
Thank you. I love you.
Bye.
All right.
I love you. Bye.
I felt so bad. My mother's been calling me every 5 minutes because I don't feel good. And she calls the other night and Cece had just spilled soup on her. We got Chinese takeout. So you know how hot soup is.
Oh, no.
Oh, she spilled. She was screaming. She had like burn mark. She's like screaming. I was like, how you feeling? She's like on FaceTime. And I'm like, okay. I'm like, Cece just burned herself. She's like, are you okay? What's wrong? I'm like, Cece's like screaming.
You like, gotta say things three or four times before they sink in.
Bless their heart though. I love them.
They're wonderful people.
Yeah, great. But Heartland. Right? What?
Is she okay?
Yeah, she's okay. We gotta put some cream on her and everything. I think she's doing all right now.
That soup. Whenever I eat Chinese food, most of the time, 90% of the time, I get wonton soup. And I started eating it with a fork now. I used to eat it with a spoon, but now I eat it with a fork.
Why?
Because when I, out of the container, I hold the container and I eat, I pick up the big giant noodle. And if I take a bite out of it, because you can't eat the whole noodle in one shot.
Right.
You have to bite it in half or whatever. So once I bite it and if it falls off the spoon and splashes into the soup and then soaks, you know, it splashes into my face and burns the shit out of me. So now I eat it with a fork. I eat the noodles out of the soup with a fork and I drink the soup. That's the only way I can do it without splashing my face.
You're practically a savage. I love drinking the soup out of the container though.
Oh, absolutely. I feel like a chef when I do that. You know, when you watch a chef show or anything, they have those soup containers of water for some reason. They don't have
just drinking water out of them. Yeah, 100%. 100%. Actually, my wife and I are fighting because I was going to sue the Chinese place, but my wife put a bomb on Cece. And it just... I
told you to put the bomb on.
It's healed up right away.
That's good. That's good.
Yeah. So.
All right. Glad she's doing all right. That could be rough.
Yeah.
That soup is boiling.
But my theory is... because we don't really know. I mean, I know Nielsen tracks these things, but I think that Netflix is just floating these little stories out there. Because I think prior to June, Netflix is going and putting little things out in the media and stuff like, well, The Suits is really taking off. Like, I think they're creating their own bullshit.
That could be. They could be spreading some buzz, you know. Try.
And it's creating this artificial buzz that's taken off.
I mean, how would you know that? Like, I could see news outlets and articles saying, like, oh, this and that. But is it coming from Netflix? Or, like, could that be? Or are the articles coming out before the shows take off? You know, like, if they pick some no-name show and they go, oh, this this blah, blah, blah show is taking off, and then it's nowhere, and then all of a sudden it's there. It's like, you know,
I think like, you know, like how influencers are used for like clothing and video games. I think they're like, they get a couple of people to talk about it, to tweet about it.
But Suits, who's talking about Suits?
I just think they're like, I think we could take this show and make it a fucking thing. And they did. It's like, it's fucking like the Eddie Murphy movie with what's his name, where they bet a dollar if they could dig. What's that movie? Oh,
Trading Places.
It's Trading Places. They're like, you think we can make Suits a thing? And some executive probably bet some other asshole a dollar. And now I'm stuck behind Suits world.
That's weird. Look at Robin. Look at Robin's comment.
Two CEOs have a bet. See?
Wow.
It's fucking Trading Places all over again. And what's worse is we don't have a naked what's her name to fucking make it all worthwhile.
Yeah.
What's her name? Jamie Lee Curtis.
Jamie Lee Curtis. Oscar winner, Jamie Lee Curtis.
Jamie Lee Curtis has had a solid body for her entire life.
That is true. That is the truth.
Right?
Yes.
I had, who was the guy? Remember he played the doctor in the Hamptons? Shit, I don't know.
What, in Seinfeld?
No, on the USA Network. There was a show.
Oh, Nip Tuck or something?
No, it wasn't. Yeah, it wasn't Nip Tuck. Let me see. Hampton's Doctor Show. I got to look this up. Anyway, the guy. What is it? Thank you, beautiful. Royal Pains.
Oh.
Okay. I had the guy on Royal Pains on.
Okay.
And he told me. You would know his name if I said it. Mark Feuerstein.
Nope.
He's been in like some stuff. Yeah, I'll show you a picture. You'd know if you see the picture of him.
Yeah, okay. No, I know that guy.
He's done bit parts in a lot of things. Right. He was telling me when they were doing Royal Pains, which preceded Suits, but I believe they were on at the same time. Because Royal Pains went to 2016.
Right.
I would guess Suits was on during that time. He told me that USA Network was the Blue Sky Network. And I go, what the fuck does that mean? He goes, if you haven't noticed, every show on the USA Network, it's always blue skies. It's always very sunny. Nothing is ever dark or grim or scary or creepy. Everything always works out in the end. Like, it's always like...
There's a lot of networks like that, I feel.
That was their angle. Whatever it was, that was their angle. Sure. That's what they were going for. But like, I never really put that together until he said it to me.
Right.
And I was like, oh, this is just easily digestible stuff.
Right.
Like, think about how complicated The Sopranos or, you know, Mad Men, all this stuff is like, they deal with dark issues and it's not easy to understand what's happening and there's subplots and all that.
It's filled with angst and worry and tension. This is very, I get what you mean.
There's you got to think about it. All this stuff is just so like on the surface and easily digestible. And, you know, so I think that's also part of it. I think they just take shit and like, here you go. But
Suits one of those things. It's a blue sky kind of show.
I think it was after they kind of got over their blue skyness, but it's still kind of the same thing where everybody's gorgeous and, you know,
Well, that's most shows. They always, you know, you're going to have attractive people as the leads for most shows, no?
True, but there's something to be said where The Sopranos disrupted all of that, and then everything started to want to be the tried to be the Sopranos, and then you have Suits, which was just like, no, everybody will be beautiful, you know, plots will be easy, there's no surprises. Yeah, you know,
but I didn't think Suits was a big deal when it was out. Like, Sopranos was a big deal while it was on,
right?
And even to and today, but Suits, I feel like its height of popularity is now for some reason.
And it doesn't make sense. And there has to be something artificially pushing this, and I refuse to accept anything else.
That's a possibility. I'm not, you know, I'm not discounting that. That I'm sure there's some, I don't know why it's the, here's your Suits. As soon as you sign into to Netflix, it's like every, it's the first, one of the first things you see. It's always trending or what, you know, popular okay. shows.
Let me ask you, because I did have a moment where I was like, should I put this on to see what the hype is about? I did have, for a split second, less than a minute, I had that like weakness of like, maybe. And I don't know if, because here's the thing, because I've been sick. So every minute I've been away on vacation, but every minute I've been home, I've been just burning through Netflix and Hulu and all this stuff. So I did have like, I was seeking something.
Right.
I don't know if I would have been doing that if I wasn't sick, but I did have a moment of weakness. Have you had that moment of like, should I see what everybody's fucking?
Well, only because it's right in my face. I go, should I watch? We haven't watched a second of it though. We haven't seen it.
Yeah, neither.
I watched. No, I can't say I haven't watched a second because I, you know, when on Netflix when you hover over it, it plays a little bit.
Yeah,
like it plays a scene from one of the episodes.
Yeah, yeah.
I've seen that and I've watched that whole scene. And it's, I'm like, all right. It's
do you like that?
I don't like. I like it. Sometimes I mute it most of the time because I'm like, if I'm flipping around looking for something to watch and I you know, and I hover on it for too long, it starts playing it. I'm like, no, I don't want to keep hearing the beginnings of shows.
Yeah.
So I mute it as I'm scrolling through.
Yeah, me too. Sometimes I like it. Sometimes I absolutely hate it.
Yeah.
I can't stand it. There's Amazon has a thing where like if you go on one of their shows, then it becomes like a bigger square. It's not even a video. And so it's like, then you gotta like click to the next one. Yeah,
it's like okay. I can't.
What are you doing?
You have to flip. That's encouraging. Maybe that's a. I think that's probably a ploy as well. It's encouraging you to flip through faster or choose a show.
Yeah,
it doesn't let you linger. It wants you to see all of its options.
Yeah,
maybe well, that's, and that, it's a marketing thing. Maybe
another marketing thing that Netflix does is they change the thumbnails on their movies constantly. So like really? You used to get just the movie poster or the cover of the DVD. That used to be the thing. Now it's like,
oh yeah. Now it's like different characters from the show or
characters or scenes. And I'll notice that too.
Wrong with that.
Like after I watch something, they'll give you a different character, but it's like, they're trying to trick you back into watching the,
well, if you ran a thing and you know, like that, you'd want to make people watch your shows more. You're already in Netflix. It's not, you know, you're there. They want you to be to like what you're choosing, what you're looking through. I get that. I feel like that's standard operating procedure. I don't see anything wrong with that.
COVID returning.
Yeah.
I didn't want to put this on this episode because we already got whacked with the warnings and everything. I looked on YouTube and everything, you know.
Well, that's fine. I mean,
yeah.
I don't mind that thing that shows up that says, oh, if you want more information on COVID, click here. I don't care. That's fine.
So I don't know what to think of all this because, well, here's just a little bit of from Ant's point of view. I've taken 3 COVID tests in the last 3 weeks and I've passed all of them, you know. Because when I first started not feeling good, I took a home test. And then when I went to the doctor the first time, they gave me one. And then I went to the doctor again recently, and we'll get more into all this. But they're saying there's a strand on the rise. Yes. But here's what I'm noticing. And I put this in the episode because President Biden is in Lake Tahoe. I believe he's a guest of Michael Corleone. He's staying overnight as a guest of the Corleones. But he's in Tahoe. And the reporters asked him about it, and he said that he asked Congress for some money for a new vaccine, which I don't think is typically a big deal because we've had like 17 of them since we had the first one, right? there's been all these boosters and stuff. So all that's being funded and still going on, and it's not in the news because nobody gives a shit. So I can't tell, Frank, if that's this, what's happening. It is a new vaccine for the new strand, so it's slightly different. But I can't tell if that's it, or because there's also right-wing Twitter or X. I don't know what we're calling it. But
calling it Twitter.
They are pumping this thing out that they're going to be closing schools soon, and it's going to come up during the election year again.
Fear mongering. That's and, what it is. That's
yeah,
what
and the, you I'm wait sorry, and see. They're going to do this, and they're
that's now, what the right wing does. We're not going to. Why would we take the sides of the scientists and the doctors? They never do. Give me one example. If you can give me one example where the right takes the side of science and agrees with science and doctors, I can't find one. I can't. With abortion, with COVID or any vaccines or anything like that, climate change. I don't know why they don't listen to scientists like ever, but they have every other. I don't know what it is, but they hear what science says and they go, ah, fuck you, I'll believe what I want to believe. Like, all right, I don't know what the fuck you want, Why do we have scientists if you're not going to listen to them?
But there's this idea that this is going to be there. A lot of the right wing people, I could give you the names on Twitter because I only follow. Actually, I don't even follow them. They just keep showing up on my feed ever since.
Yep.
What's his name? Bought the thing. But they're like, you wait and see. Like, here it comes. Like, this is going to be, they're making it seem like it's going to be a big part of the election next year. And I was calling bullshit up until, and I feel like I'm still calling bullshit, but the fact that Biden did ask Congress for money to do this, I'm kind of like, oh, is this really going to be happening? Now, let me just say this too. He asked for $40 million, which is $6 to the rest of them. I mean, when you're asking Congress for money, $40 million is nothing.
Yeah, it's push. You want a vaccine to go out there. I mean, whenever something pops up, they try to get a vaccine for it. I don't understand what, I do not understand what the big problem some people have with trying to get medicine to people.
What's the problem? I still, even if they made it in the strand or whatever, I still don't think that they would make anything mandatory ever again. I just think it would be a nightmare.
And if they did, if the right, what they're saying is correct about, oh, it's about the election and all this stuff, it would only, even if they said nothing, if the right said nothing about this and, let's say Biden and everybody, all this COVID stuff popped up again and they started closing stuff, then they could just go out there and fuel up their base and say, see, this is going to be a huge thing. They don't have to shit on it so soon. Like, even if they want, if their goal is to shit on everything that the left does, which is their goal, it just seems premature. And we're not even near, we're over a year away from the election. So, this winter's coming up. If the vaccine or COVID springs up again, by the time next summer rolls around, nobody's going to, this isn't going to affect the election.
I think Robin's got it. Just another scam from big toilet paper industry. It's true.
It could be.
They got to get themselves back up to where they were. You know what I'm saying?
Big TP.
Oh, those are the good old days when they were selling out like crazy.
Couldn't spare a square in those days.
Yeah, I don't know what it is. I honestly, even if everybody agreed right and left that we needed mandates and all this stuff, I still don't think they would do it, because I think a mandate or anything like that is a death sentence for your party going into an election. I just
probably don't. Which I don't get. I don't understand people's defiance of a health mandate.
Well, America.
Like, no, we don't care if we're sick. It's like, okay, all right, then go get sick. What do you want me to tell you?
Can I ask you a question, though?
No.
not just, I don't know if this is just me because I'm sick, but I feel like I have never interacted or heard from more people being sick in the summer ever than I have for this summer. I'm not saying this is COVID related or whatever it is, because I don't have COVID, but I feel like I have never heard of more people being sick ever before than I have this summer in particular. And I feel like we've talked about this last summer because everybody was like, nobody was getting flu shots because it was COVID and all this stuff. And so now it's catching up. And that was last summer. But this summer, I feel like everybody, I know somebody who knows somebody who's sick for sure.
Well, if that's true, it's probably my estimation would be that the height of it was last summer. And it's going to gradually taper off that amount of sick people. You know, if what you're saying is true in terms of it was COVID, nobody got the flu shot, all this stuff, then the height of it was probably last summer, and it's going to fade out and taper off each summer to summer. That's if what you're saying is true.
I feel like it's more this summer than it was last summer, but I don't know.
Oh, whatever it is, I feel like it'll taper off.
Yeah, so, I mean, we'll see, but I don't think...
I don't understand everybody's... If this wasn't in the news, or if it was... If everybody in the news was like, yeah, it's going to, you know, it's going to be bad, and let's do whatever we can to stop it, then would everybody else go, yeah, maybe we should do whatever we can to stop it? Or is it the news leading the people, or is it the people leading the news?
Yeah, that's kind of what it is, because it's Brian Krasenstein.
All right.
Krasenstein, he's a big one. And there's another guy, too, who I like, every time I open Twitter, it's something of like, you watch and see, like, it's coming back. It's going to be a thing. They're going to be shutdowns again and all this stuff. And I'm just like, I just don't see. Again, even if we kind of Colin Rugg, R-U-G-G. Mm-hmm. He's another one of these guys that just only tells you a little part of the story. But anyway, I don't know. I don't think it's real. Again, I was ignoring it up until Biden said he was okaying. It's a little nugget, but it's still worth mentioning, I felt.
Yeah, I feel like, why not? If he did nothing, then people would be like, oh, it's coming back and he's doing nothing. You know, so he's got to act on these things. You know, a million Americans died, not to mention the millions around the world over a couple of year period. You know, it's not nothing. You know, why wouldn't you want to be prepared for it? I don't understand why everybody's so against being prepared for a fucking disease. What is that? Why is that such a controversial issue? Just
because everybody wants to be done with it. They don't want to go through it all again.
I get that. But if you want to be done with it, you follow the rules and we'll be done with it. You know, do what you got to do to not get it. Go through the procedures. Wear a fucking thing, and a mask, or get a shot, and we're done. And we don't have to think about it anymore. But no, everybody's like, oh, fuck that. I'm not wearing a mask. And they bring it home, and it's a, I don't know.
2 months ago. No, it's okay. 2 months ago, Yevgeny Prigozhin, the Wagner mercenary general, mounted what lasted literally a day. But everybody thought that this would be the thing that could possibly take down Vladimir Putin. Then, bizarrely, Putin, he was marching on Moscow. Remember, Moscow was getting ready with all the tanks and everything. Then the two of them supposedly spoke and he agreed to back down. They were going to send him off to Belarus where he would be housed over there. And then last Wednesday, when we were away on vacation, plane crashes over there, 10 bodies recovered. It has been quadruple confirmed that Yevgeny Prigozhin was one of the guys who was on this plane that just so happened to crash.
Yeah, I buy that. Like, he wasn't taken out.
I mean, this is the worst. Like, this isn't even a cover-up. Like,
yeah, this is just blatant. I mean, when this is all over, I can't... there's gotta be... I don't want to say repercussions, but, like... You know, for war... isn't there talks of, like, bringing Putin up on war crimes and all this stuff? And I feel like there's something to that, like, where the UN is gonna penalize or bring him to task. I don't know what it is, but I thought that there were talks about, you know, charging him with war crimes.
I mean, there should be. You know, I can't. He's not a straightforward guy. You know,
that's true.
I'm sorry. A preliminary U.S. intelligence assessment concluded that an intentional explosion caused the plane to go down. Uh-huh. So, you know, obviously, who else would want to see this guy go but Vladimir Putin?
I would imagine so. And it's confirmed he was on the plane?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, it was confirmed. They figured it out. And now, like, the story from today was Russian authorities confirmed that it was him on the plane. So it's like, even they're like, yeah, it was him.
Yeah, we got him. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. We got him. We got him. I mean, it was him. He was on the plane. What a tragedy.
Yeah.
What a triumph. I mean, what a tragedy.
Yeah. This thing's got to end soon. I don't know when it's going to end, but it's got to end with Russia losing. And because if they win, it's a problem. That's why we're so invested in this thing.
I was watching JFK in the movie.
Heard of it.
And so they came out with a, we've updated the JFK movie documentary. Mm-hmm. So I was watching that from Oliver Stone. And, you know, there's so much to, they really kind of dug into the fact that Dulles and the CIA and all these guys were fucking with Kennedy. Mm-hmm. And the Bay of Pigs and all this stuff, and they were always feeding him false information, and he was really mad, and he wanted to kind of like redo the CIA and all this kind of jazz and all this stuff. Well, a lot of the documents that came out after the movie kind of really explored this whole thing and the military industrial complex and all that kind of stuff, you know. And it's so true. Like, if you look at it, over the course of history, even though we've had, for the most part, since World War II, what I would consider world peace, you know, we don't have nations lining up against each other, you know, axis of evil and all, you know, we don't have any of that anymore. But there's always
we just talked about the Russia versus Ukraine.
That's not a world war.
Oh, not a world war. No.
Yeah, I'm saying we've had world peace, but that's my point. We've had world peace since World War II, but we've always had these little wars and battles and conflicts and this and that.
Yeah, a lot of big wars during since.
And there's always sort of a reason to send some tanks and cells. You know, like, there's always a reason for us to, like, you look at how much we spend on tanks and guns and ammunition and all this.
What's the point? What's your point?
So my point is that.
Sorry, I didn't mean to rush you.
No, I love that you did it. The point is that I don't think this Ukraine-Russia thing is ever going to, it seems like a really comfy war. You know, like, it seems like we've worn out our stay in the Middle East, and everybody was so sick and tired of Afghanistan that we literally just left millions of dollars worth of shit there and just got out of it. But now we have this Ukraine-Russian thing, and it's kind of like, okay, everybody seems pretty okay, like, with us just constantly just feeding money into this machine, you know, and sending this and sending that. And it's like, we can't end this any sooner. We can't figure this out.
What do you mean by we?
Not just the United States, England, you know, the, well, what that, you
call? It's very touchy. I mean, once another country enters the fray,
I know,
it becomes a huge war, a bigger war than it is. And then Russia attacks that. Like, let's say England, you know, attacks Russia. Now Russia's going to attack England, and it becomes this huge thing. Now who's going to come to England's defense? And it spreads to a world war. That's why right now it's contained to two countries going after each other. One is in Ukraine is defending itself against Russia's advances. And, you know, they're just trying to defend their land, and that's that. I mean, it's very cut and dry, I think, but it's also one of these, you don't want to put your troops in the mix, because then it opens you up to, you know, well, they got to defend themselves against this country and that country. So it becomes a world war if you start involving other countries.
I don't disagree with you.
So we're trying to, you know, steer clear of that.
I don't disagree with you. You're right. It is a delicate thing. On the other hand, how much do you think we've given the Ukraine since this all started?
Oh, tons. Oh, yeah, I don't know. What are the billions? A couple billion? Yeah, what was it?
$75 billion.
$75 billion.
That's a lot of money.
It is a lot of money.
I kind of want to see something for that at this point. Like, again, last year, and it all started, and they need tanks, and they need defense, and I'm all for it.
I kind of thought that Russia would roll right through Ukraine, but Ukraine's been fighting off Russia. They've been taking back some areas, and it's not, you know, it's not going to happen overnight.
Right, which is great. Which is great. But,
you know, Ukraine's not, you know.
And I don't want to say anything out of school here. You tell me if I'm wrong. I feel like you might tell me I am. But we poured $75 billion into this. My uncle, Uncle Jamie, went there, did a whole fucking art show for like 3 weeks. Never had any issues. It's fucking eating Ukraine McDonald's and all this shit. And it just like, is there, how much... Do they need $75 billion to stop
this? I'm sure the whole... Well, okay.
I don't even know what this war is anymore at this point.
Well, it's happening in... It's not happening in every single, you know, city in the country.
So they're fighting over some dirt patch, you know, in the corner of the country that nobody probably gives a shit about, and this is costing us $75 billion?
The capital, the this, that. They're fighting over cities, but, you know, your uncle probably went to places where the war isn't raging. It's a huge place, you know. You got picture if the war was happening here in if the war was happening in New Mexico, would we be, you know, people would still come in and out of New York, and it would probably, you know what I mean.
True.
It's a huge place, so it's not, you know, it's not the entire country has, you know, is shooting at Russians. It's wherever the Russians are. It's probably, you know, there's a line, there's a front line, and I'm sure it's, you know, it was far away from where they were.
Well, listen, $75 billion is starting to get... We're getting to the point where I'm kind of like, okay, something's going to happen here. Because, you know, here's the thing on the other hand, too. I don't know if you'd know about this, but... And this is a really Republican thing to say. So.
Oh, God, here we go.
But you look at, like, you look at what's happening in New York City, and Mayor Adams is like, he's asking, he needs money to house the amount of migrants that have moved into this, like the cities, they're running out of money. They're running out of options and money. He's asked the federal government for help. Like all this kinds of crazy shit's going on. You look at inflation and the amount of stuff. I go, how much do you think a cup of noodle soup is?
I don't know.
Like 99 cents. It was like 99 cents forever. It's like $1.99 now. Like even salty noodles, over salted noodles that you put hot water in, you have to use your own hot water, is gone. Like it's crazy. And everybody's paying all this money and everything. And it's like, I just don't know what we're doing anymore with this stuff. Like everybody, like think of the outcry to stop the Afghan war. Everybody was on the same, at the end of it, everybody was on the same page of just get out already. Mm-hmm. Even the people that wanted to criticize Biden for how he do it were still like, whatever, we're out of it, right? We got out of that just to fucking get into this. I mean, this we're not is, we into could be talking this. About this 5 years from now.
We're not fighting this war. We're just
paying for it.
One side, yeah.
We're fucking paying for it. And listen, I'm not naive, Frank. I understand that you do have to spend X amount of money on international diplomacy to keep everything, because you don't want China and Russia getting together and it getting out of control. And like you said, turning, you don't want that. So yeah, I'm okay with
allotted for this stuff. It's not like we're just, you know, I feel like for the past how many 30, 40, 50 years, we've been spending money outside of our country to either on wars or diplomacy, whatever it is. This is money that's going to, it's going to go somewhere where, what's the word for what we're doing to Russia? When we punish them economically,
sanctioning
Russia, you know, so money is going back and forth in different ways. And yeah, we're giving a lot of money to Ukraine, but it's to hold Russia at bay. If Russia takes over Ukraine, it'd be a nightmare. You know, they would You think they'd stop there? You think they're going to stop it? You know, who knows? All of a sudden, they got this huge chunk of Europe.
Initially, I thought that. But now, seeing as how much they can't even take over this little country, I wouldn't be so concerned.
Maybe, but...
I just wouldn't be so concerned.
Ukraine isn't a little country.
And I can't help but think that this isn't just part of our military industrial complex.
Yeah, maybe.
You know, like, let's not win it. Let's just keep pumping money into it. And our companies who make the tanks and the bullets, and they'll make money, and our army will make money. Their training people will be happy. You know, all this kind of shit that has just been going on since the dawn of time.
Oh, believe me, if we could end, I wish we could stop all the war and stop funding. You know, we could take some funding away from military, you know, but we're going to have to keep, you know, our military. Everybody wants a strong military. Got to keep America's military strong. I get that. But yeah, you're right. It could be, I don't think we're giving money to the Ukraine, and I'm, you know, we're not sending troops over there. That's an important thing that's a big distinction.
It is.
Yeah, I mean, and we said this is an ally, and we're going to defend them until it's over. We can't all of a sudden go, nah, you know what? We decided we're not going to defend you anymore. Get fucked.
It is, but again, this gave rise to the Trumpsters, which is, and by the way, Trump is not the first person. You go back to the world wars themselves and the isolationists. That this was a thing back then of like, let's not worry about the rest of the world. Let's just take care of our own shit. So he's not the one who started this, but that rise of this sort of feeling again that Trump rode the wave of was exactly this of like, let's not spend so much money in the Middle East. Let's bring that money and fix our own problems.
But he didn't do any of that.
Now it's not the Middle East, it's Ukraine.
Yeah, but he didn't pull out of the Middle East. Number one.
I'm just talking about the sentiment of we need to spend our money here, fixing our problems here first.
Which we're actually doing. Biden passed the biggest infrastructure bill in the history of the country. That was huge. So there's that. Then there's he's trying to give everybody the what's it called? To compare.
Oh, don't even get me started on the college, the fucking...
No. To compare, Trump was doing trickle-down, let's give tax breaks to the fucking billionaires.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, how much did that work? Did that do anything? No, didn't do anything. The billionaires just kept the money, and that was it. So Biden, you know, child tax credits, all this stuff that he's trying to give back to us. Yeah, it was a little, but whatever, you know, it's not. I'm not saying it's perfect, but at least he's trying to not. He's trying to tax the wealthy, 400,000 income plus is getting taxed. You know, ours didn't go up taxes. So
the people that want to stop the college loan forgiveness thing drive me fucking crazy. Bird, well, yeah,
what is that about? That's
I can't. We can't even talk about it. I can't. I'll fucking die
it's
of coughing.
Fucking enraging. No, we can't save college kids' money because I had to pay. I had to pay for college. Yeah. Yeah, we're not talking about you asshole.
Because the fuck you think the college kids are going to spend it on? But shit that they're going to buy that's going to just help the economy to begin with. Yeah. We didn't get into World War II until Pearl Harbor, which again, to further illustrate my point, we were so isolationist at the time that they felt like the only way we could do it is if that's that theory of we knew it was coming and we let them attack us anyway, because there would be no other way to change the feeling of the country to get involved in something that we wanted no fucking part in. But by the way, and this is something that we've been struggling with since before we even became a country. Because if you remember, when we fought England to become independent, France helped us. And then 5 years after that, France needed help because France was fighting Britain. And we decided to stay the fuck out of it because we felt like we couldn't get involved because we'd be dragged into the whole thing. So we've been fighting this international thing since the beginning of our time. So it's nothing new, but.
Now, in the chat, Christine says, what about our veterans? The Department of Veteran Affairs has suffered and we have vets living under bridges. I get that. Now, we tried over the last couple of years with Biden in office and with Democrats trying to put through stuff. We tried to put through benefits for veterans. And the Democrats all voted, 100% of Democrats voted yay, and 174 Republicans voted it down. No, so no benefits for the veterans there. Well, because Republicans voted it down.
Didn't Trump
low cost of insulin? What?
I'm sorry. Go ahead. You can keep going. But didn't Trump do a veteran? Didn't he do something that redid the VA hospitals? I think. I thought he passed something for the VA hospitals. I could be wrong.
I don't know about that.
Go ahead.
But lowering cost of insulin, the Republicans vote. The Democrats all voted unanimously to lower the cost of insulin. Republicans all voted it down, with the exception of 12 people. Oil and gas price gouging at the pumps. Democrats all voted, well, with the exception of 4 people. 217 Democrats voted yes. Unanimous Republican voting said no. They said no. Voted that down. When we had the baby formula shortage, 100%, 200 of the Democrats voted yes, a couple of independents, whatever it was. But 219 Democrats voted yes, 192 Republicans voted no. Why would they vote against this stuff?
I don't want to say anything.
You think they want to see the problems fixed? No, they want to see problems so they can go, hey, look at all those problems. I don't see the Democrats fixing it. Because they're voting it down. The Republicans are voting it down. And I'm sorry, but that's what's happening. You could say, oh, look, Frank is a Democrat. You know, what's it called?
Liberal pussy,
right. But facts are Republicans are stopping progress because they want to see this administration fail. And that's just the bottom line of it. So when you talk about, oh, we need to take care of ourselves first. Yeah, we're trying to do that. But when the Republicans keep blocking everything, it makes it difficult to take care of ourselves first. So,
Jay Sabbath is on. She's on vacation. Actually, we poorly planned vacations because I think she's away for a couple of days, and then you're going away in September
mid September. Yeah. We are going away for 7 days.
We're going to have some staggered shows here with a lot of Cuddles appearances, I think, over the next couple of weeks and months.
If I could somehow phone in from where I am.
Oh, that would be great.
I don't know. I'll try.
I'm not going to hold you to that, but I would love.
I will be in the country.
I don't know if you want to say where you're going. You know, don't even say it because it will tease it if you do feel comfortable. I would love some shots of where you go because I think
I'll definitely.
It'll be beautiful.
Be some good shots.
What did you think of the first Republican debate? Did you watch it? Did you have any thoughts on that?
No, I didn't watch any of it.
Okay.
I saw a couple of clips here and there. I had no interest in watching them fight each other. The only thing I did see, the only clip I saw, which enraged me by itself, it was a 2-second thing when they asked all the Republicans on the stage, how many of you believe in man-made climate change? And not one Republican raised their hand. It's like, get the fucking, you know, get your... You're in the pocket of all the oil companies and the gas. You know, you're toting the Republican line for your own interests. Why can't you? Why is it so difficult to agree with science? I don't understand Republicans' point of view.
That Rami Swar, I don't know his name, but he said he believed in it. There's clips online that he was like, "Of course it's happening," and then he said it was a hoax during the debate.
Of course he did.
So everybody called him out for that.
Yeah, well, whatever they want to hear. I'll tell you whatever you want to hear. You go, as long as you vote for me. Is it a hoax? Sure, it's a hoax. Whatever you want. But, you know, it's enraging because we're living it now. We've got wildfires everywhere. We've got flooding in places where there was never flooding before. We got the waters warmer than they ever been. Sharks are now fucking on our coasts everywhere. It's like the storms are getting bigger and bigger. And Republicans, I feel, or people who are against climate change or don't believe in it are going, well, my home in Florida isn't flooded. Yeah, it's not going to happen overnight. It's going to happen quickly, but it's going to happen over a few years. Now all the levels are going to rise, the ice caps are going to melt, and we're going to have, everything's going to get fucked up. So, you know, you could sit here and, you know, we're just going to sit back and go, you know what? You want to live with this, with everything fucked up, live with it fucked up. What are we going to do? We can't, it's tiresome trying to jam science in people's faces when they just don't want to hear it.
I didn't watch it either because I was in Florida, and I was just in a happy place.
It wasn't on every TV in Florida.
big down there. Republicans are big down there.
I would imagine.
But I was avoiding it. But I did come across some clips. You know, it's funny. I wasn't on social a lot, but I did come across some clips of it. I thought DeSantis looked terrible. Like he just had a bad night. I thought the crowd was against Christie, who was actually making some decent points. I thought Nikki Haley was the biggest surprise of all. Did you see her answer about abortion?
No, I didn't see any of it.
She was like, we should cut out the bullshit with abortion. She's like, this is this. Like, she just, I can't recite it all for you, but she just like layered out an answer. And I was like, that is actually a common sense approach to this. Because, you know, she didn't toe the typical line of, well,
what,
like,
did she say? What was the point she was making?
It was like, you can't just deny women health care. You know, it was like, you can't do, she was like, we need to be sensible about late term abortion, but you can't just deny women health care. Like, we got to figure out a way. It doesn't have to be black and white, all or none. Like, we could figure out a way to make this, you know, like logical. And
I agree with that. Now, yeah, because what's his name? DeSantis. I did hear that DeSantis was saying stuff about Democrats. It's late, up to the moment of birth. It's like, no, that's not how it works.
And it doesn't. Yeah, that's like such a small percentage. But you know, it's, you know, the worst part about DeSantis was they asked them. I saw a clip where they asked them if Trump would secure the nomination, would they support him? And a bunch of people put their hands up first, and then
I saw Christie.
Yeah, and then like DeSantis did the same thing. He like looked around. And he's like, oh, everybody's doing it, so I got to do it too. It's like, dickhead. That's the moment to be like, no, fuck that. Like, you have an opportunity to stand out from the rest of the dopes on stage.
Because you know why? Because the people watching, the base, the Republican base, is looking for everybody to go, oh, yay, Republican, fuck Democrats. So if a Republican candidate went up there and said, I might vote Democrat if I had to, you're out. There's no wavering on that line for some reason.
Yeah.
I don't get it, but that's the problem. That's the problem we have.
Well, I was impressed with Nikki Haley, and it was painfully It was painfully obvious that Ramsey Swarzy is going to be Trump's nominee, running mate, vice presidential running mate. Like, a couple of those guys up there were clearly up there just to be the VP, going for the VP thing. Anyway, this is a quick one, Frank. Tech City, there was a bunch of people, because you could buy land not by name in this country. You know, you could buy it through a corporation. Mm-hmm. And a bunch of people were buying $1 billion worth of land near a California military base. And it turned 50,000, more than 50,000 acres of land surrounding Travis Air Force Base. Flannery Associates has been buying this up since 2018. So for 5 years, this has been going on and nobody really knew who was involved in it. And it turns out that it's Lorraine Powell Jobs.
I knew it.
And LinkedIn co-founder Reid Hoffman.
Okay, so they've been buying up this land.
They've been buying up this land, and so they're now the largest landowners in Solano County, which is 60 miles northeast of San Francisco, which sparked concern that a foreign entity was behind the purchases, which is kind of scary that a foreign country could just buy up land and create their own city, which is kind of, again, crazy, because what's that stupid movie with Will Ferrell and Zach Galifianakis?
With what? With Will Ferrell?
Will Ferrell and Zach Galifianakis, where they're the politicians running Congress, whatever that.
I forget what it's called, the candidate or something like that.
Yeah, but in that movie, like, China was like buying land. It's so absurd. China was buying land in America because it would have been cheap, like the child labor or something would have been cheaper in America at that point, and some weird fucking thing.
Yeah, but it's the campaign. Thank you, Sarah.
The campaign. Thank you, Sarah. But it could really happen. Anyway, these guys bought up all this land, and now they're saying that they're going to be starting this, like, their own little, like, tech city, you know?
So what do you mean by tech city? Is it like a a city where people could live, or is it like one giant computer place, computery?
No, it's like a city where people can live, but similar to like the Wall and some of those other places. Kanye, remember we were talking about all that shit? Like everybody is rushing to build their own futuristic cities.
I wonder how that wall is going. The last thing I saw was is it Saudi Arabia? I don't remember exactly where they're building that wall thing.
Yeah.
But the last I saw, they were digging the trench that it's going to be built in, and it's like a mile long thing that they're I wonder how that's going.
Like, I don't know. What,
and if that's going to be a successful thing and when that's going to be up and running.
I feel like some of these new fangled things, like, I mean, name one person that has made money off an NFT in the last 2 years. Like, I mean, I don't know anybody who went out and bought all that stupid shit that is like, oh, I'm raking it in.
Donald Trump made some money off of those.
That's true.
$4 million off.
Yeah. Some of these moves I'm not so sure about. Barbie just continues to absolutely, completely fucking dominate. I mean,
go Barbie.
It's not even close what Barbie is doing. Barbie, here, hold on. Barbie has hit $1.34 billion in revenue, and it is the highest earning Warner Brothers film of all time.
That is crazy and awesome at the same time.
Like Warner Brothers. I mean, you're talking about the Batman movies. You know, you're like Heath Ledger Batman was so huge, not as big as the Barbie movie. Like, it's crazy. The Gran Turismo came out and just beat Barbie. I mean, just barely beat Barbie in the box office this weekend. But this is like the ninth week that Barbie is out.
Keep going, Barbie. What the hell? Why not?
Yeah.
Man. You know, did we talk about Oppenheimer at all? I don't remember if we did.
I don't know if we did or not. I can't remember. I think we did. Did we?
All right, maybe we did.
I don't remember.
I didn't like it.
But again, it's hysterical to me that Oppenheimer was supposed to be the spark conversation of summer 2023. And it's fucking Barbie.
You think Barbie will be nominated for Best Picture?
I mean, how could it not be?
Hey, Batman wasn't. Dark Knight wasn't.
I mean, that's true, but that was before they did that was when it was five films. Now that it was 10 films get nominated, how can you not? I mean, I don't know if for Best Picture, but Best Director or Screenplay or Actress, or it's going to get a bunch of awards. It has to.
Oh, I'm sure it will. Yeah, I could see that. Director, yeah, sure. But would a movie like Barbie be up for Best Picture? And Beaver Boys has a request. I don't know if we could oblige Beaver Boy.
I would never deny Beaver Boys. Can you guys take off your shirts?
It's a little out of nowhere.
Yeah. It's disgusting, but I'm flattered. I'm actually feeling better after reading that comment than
it was. It was a nice little pick me up.
It's nice to be flirted with. I appreciate that, Beaver Boys. So yeah, Barbie continues to dominate. Good for Barbie. Elton John will be dead soon. Who's going to be dead first, me or Elton John?
It's a tough one. Elton John, it wasn't as bad as that. He fell. He's not sick or anything. He just fell, right?
He fell. He was hospitalized after falling in a French villa. They say he's out and he's okay. I don't know. I think, listen.
What is he, 70-something? He's going to fall.
76, yeah.
Okay. The way, you know, he's jumping around on stage and stuff, you know, 76, you're gonna trip a little here and there. It happens.
I'm just saying, you fall and break that hip, you usually don't have much longer. That's always the thing.
He broke his hip. Did he break his hip?
They say he didn't break his hip, but I think it's all in the suits conspiracy. I think they're covering it up.
See, why would they tell us he fell but didn't break his hip? Why would they even tell us he fell?
I don't know. Why is Suits the number one streaming show in the country? We just can't explain these things.
Why does Radio Shack ask for your phone number when you buy batteries? Kramer. I don't know.
They say he's back with his family now, and he's doing well. Who knows?
The rest of the Johns.
Yeah, the rest of the Johns.
The John family.
Are you John? She was talking to that John over there.
Do you call him Mr. Sir John? Like Mr. John?
I think you got to call him Sir Elton.
Sir Elton John. So, like, if he goes to a restaurant and they call his table, Is it Sir Elton John Party of Six?
Oh, good question. I think in that case you go John Party of Four. Yeah,
John.
I think.
Oh, we lost you a second.
Sorry, which is a weird thing to just say, like, just John. It's a weird name to just roll out there.
Yeah, I mean, it's you think he's ever been called Mr. John in his life?
Probably before he got knighted.
So before he was knighted, there was a point in his life where he was. I can't imagine calling Elton John Mr. John, but it had to have happened.
Probably.
It's just a weird thing for him to go by.
Yeah.
You know, it's just that. He's always Elton John, you know, it's just Mr. John right this way.
Like, it is so easy to say Elton John. Just rolls off your tongue.
Right. It's like Billy Joel. Mr. Joel is a little easier to say, but it's Billy Joel. It's just Billy Joel. This way, Billy Joel.
Vacation recap.
You want to go?
How was your time off?
Time off was nice. So my wife and I started... About 8 months ago, we
just started... the cabinet because we did this before we left. Was that the story you were going to tell?
Yeah, it was a story. All right, I got nothing then.
We did that last episode before we went away.
All right, then I don't know what to tell you. What did we do? So we got rid of a lot of stuff in the house because we got rid of in our living room. There was this TV. It was a 60-inch TV, but it was from like 25 years ago, and it still had the huge tube back to it. It's a flat screen, but it had the huge tube, you know, that kind of television. And it was in our living room, and we never use it, never watch it. It just sat there on its stand, collected dust. We got rid of that.
You never watched that TV?
Recently. We don't really use it. We use the TV in downstairs or in the bedroom or, you know, we don't really watch this one.
Wow, okay.
So we got rid of it. And another reason we never really watched it is because the picture was off.
Oh, okay.
The coloring, it didn't give a good picture anymore. So we got rid of that. We got rid of this refrigerator that was in our garage forever. That was just an old piece of junk that I finally had to take the doors off and haul it out to the curb. And you know, we just got rid of a lot of junk in our house. Some paint. I had a shit ton of paint that I had to drive to this stop event and drop it off at a safe recycling event. It's just, yeah, so we got rid of a lot of junk.
There is nothing better than getting rid of some old shit that you just don't use anymore.
It's so freeing. There's just this room. I'm looking at an empty space in my living room right now going, what am I going to do with this space?
It's great.
It's nice.
Yeah, never fill it.
Never fill it.
The best, this is going to be hard to say because my wife is listening. The best time in my life was when I had my bachelor pad and it was literally empty. Like it was the barest of bare bones.
So a TV and a milk crate, basically.
No, it's simple little TV stand, TV, couch. Little table, little desk. There was not, like, I could have if we were hit by a war, I could have grabbed everything I owned and evacuated in 15 minutes. It would have been so easy, you know? But that was because, like, all my shit was, like, in the attic of my parents, you know, like, all that stuff.
Yeah, you had storage somewhere else.
It was somewhere else. But it was so freeing. There was never a lot to clean up or put away because there just wasn't a lot of stuff, you know? Like, I can remember moments of, like...
Are you blaming your wife for clutter in your house?
No, but I'm making a point of, like, I would be like, oh, I want to bake a cake or I want to do this. And I'd have to, like, go out and buy a pan or buy a knife, you know? And then I would have that knife. Like, that's kind of how it was. And it was so simple. And now you're just like... I don't know. There's just like, you know, and then like, I mean, I don't know if you have this too, your mother, your brother, people bring stuff over and then they're like, oh yeah, well, you know, remember this was Aunt Gladys's and you're like, yeah, oh, I love Aunt Gladys. I keep this, put this thing over here. You know, you just build up all this
shit. Yeah. It's just stuff that's in your house that you're just, it's just there because you have it.
Just have it. And with the kids, it's like They drew on this. We have just boxes of paper in the garage of just artwork.
And, just a huge fire hazard in your garage.
Yeah, and you're like, we're never gonna look at this, but you just don't have the heart to throw it away.
You want me to throw it away? I'll come over and clear it all out.
Feels like you're on a hot streak now, you know?
I'll take a flamethrower.
But there's just something to it where you're like, the fucking get it out, and you get it out. And you see that space, like you said, and you're like, this is great.
And half the fun is every now and then you take a look out the window, see if someone picked it up. We had this this glass stand, TV stand. It had like two, three levels on it. And the top level, obviously, was the TV. And it was in perfect condition, you know, metal and glass. And we put it out to the curb. We didn't want it anymore. We didn't need it. So we just put it at the curb. Anybody who wanted it could take it. But we had a scheduled pickup for the garbage to come get it. Someone picked it up. So I hope it's, you know, it was a nice, you know, nice thing. But we had no use for it anymore. So someone picked it up. So that's good. The garbage men didn't have to get that. But
I had a Christmas tree one year that I was like, I put it out and I forget what it was. But it was some weird circumstance. We went away and whatever. I don't know. It was just in the garage. And then it was like February. And I was like, I don't know if I could put this Christmas tree out anymore. And I was like, I'll save it and I'll like, cut it up and I'll burn it in the fireplace, which is not a good idea. But I was like, I'm going to just do this. I think the Christmas tree sat in my garage for like 8 months. Like it was like summertime. There was a Christmas tree in my garage. It was so stupid. And I remember like the day, like my father came to visit and finally was like, we're throwing this out today.
So wait, it was a fake Christmas tree or a real Christmas tree?
It was a real Christmas tree.
So you had a real dead Christmas tree in your garage for 8 months?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's
ridiculous. You can't just bring, isn't it that there's like a week where you just bring it out to the curb? Everybody's trees are at the curb.
But we missed that week because like we were away. Yeah, so it was like one of those weird things that just stayed in the garage, and then I became like defiant about it, and I was like, I'm going to handle this, and I never did.
Here's the thing that happened over the our vacation. I decided, my wife and I, we came up with this agreement that we're going to live our lives comfortably.
Swinging?
Okay. No.
No, okay.
But that's like the opposite of comfortable. That's the most uncomfortable thing.
True.
For us, anyway. But like I went online and I bought a bunch of pants that will fit me now because I bought a new pair of shoes that I have, you know, that they're nice and comfortable.
Yeah.
We got these new towels for the bathroom, you know, it's just everything. We're like, you know what? Cause I was holding on to jeans and shorts that I've just had for a long time and they're just a little tight on me now. A little belly, you know, and I, you know what, I'm letting them go because I'm like, you know what, I don't want to be uncomfortable wearing these clothes. So I'm like, you know what, they're gone. And I bought a size up. I caved and I went, you know what, I'm probably not going to lose this gut. So let me just buy pants that fit me now. And then that was it. So now I'm comfortable.
Well, that's another thing too. Like my wife always is like, why do you, these socks are like.
Yeah, that's my next step. It sucks.
She's like, they're almost nothing. Like, what do you, I'm like, I don't know if that's a man thing or just a human thing of like, we just get into routines and this is our clothes and that's our thing. And we just wear it till it breaks off or dies or, you know, I don't know.
Yeah. No, I that's another thing. My socks, I had a couple of pairs of socks that, you know, I like them. But they had like little holes in the bottom of them. I'm like, all right, you know what? It's time for these to go.
Yeah.
You know, my toes were coming through them. I'm like, I can't anymore. I threw them out. Yeah. Like anything with holes in them or they just don't fit or there's no match or whatever the hell. I'm like, that's it. I'm not living my life like this anymore. No, I just decided. And I talked to, you know, Aaron and I were on the same page. We're just going to
live a life of comfort. I love
gotta
that.
Be comfortable. You got to be comfortable in life. I don't want to go through life, you know, like, cinched in with my pants cutting my circulation off. I can't do it. Plus my back, you know, I've had back surgery a long time ago, but if I wear pants that are too tight around my hips, it bothers my back.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's not the old injury, but it's close, and it's, you know, it's a pain in the ass. And if I screw up my back, it's bad for a couple of days. So anything that's too tight around my waist, I'm like, nope, I'm not going to deal with that anymore. So I'm getting rid of that. Donating whatever we can donate, throwing out the rest, and that's it.
Towels are another thing too. Like, I can tell you that there are towels in this house that are 25 years old that have come from my previous house.
Yeah, you know, and if they're okay, then they're fine, you know. But we got, remember that the JSAB's charity golf outing thing?
Yeah.
So we won a gift certificate to this.
Is that what started all of it? The sheets and the towels?
No, I mean, it contributed. It contributed to it.
Okay.
But what started it, I think, was just one day, it was my back. Like, I was like, I was wearing a pair of pants that were just like too tight. I'm like, I can't hold on to these anymore. They're just not worth going through this again. So I took, you know, I got rid of them. And then I went online and I bought these. Oh my God. All right. They haven't paid me any money to say this. This is unsolicited. But I went online and Lee's jeans, not Levi's, which I'm sure are fine, but Lee's.
L-E-E apostrophe S?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I've seen them.
They make jeans. They're like $20, $25, maybe even cheaper on some. There's some sales that go on. And they're made of the most comfortable material. I don't even know what the hell it is. But they're so soft, and they're like stretchy. It's almost like sweatpants, yeah. But they're jeans. And I'm like, oh my God, this is amazing.
I don't know when this happened.
Why am I only discovering this now?
I don't know when this happened, but jeans suddenly became stretchy and like dungaree. Like not so, by the way, dungarees. What kind of a fucking...
Dungarees.
Word is that? But anyway, yeah, they're not... They remember they used to be like hard and like it would hurt to put them on and everything?
They'd be a little craggly and like stiff.
Yeah.
They feel like sweatpants, and they're stretchy around the waist and everything. They're so nice.
They're comfortable, yeah.
So I bought like three pairs of those, and I'm like, this is amazing. I bought Lee's shorts, so now I got a bunch of pairs of shorts from them.
You're a Lee man now.
Yeah, I'm a Lee man. They're just so good. They're comfortable. I don't understand. And they're not expensive. They're not like $100 pair of shorts or something. The shorts I got literally for $13. They're some of the most comfortable pair of shorts that I own.
Jeggings. So jeggings was it. It started with jeggings, which was this shit that was like, looked like jeans, but were totally like jogging pants and stretchy pants. And it was such a joke. I wonder what year jeggings started, Paul. If somebody could look that up. It was such a joke. And people were like, this is so stupid. But then all of a sudden, every major jean company was kind of like, we should soften up our jeans. And they all started like incorporating these jeggings things into the... Now they're all kind of like that.
I'm in. I mean, they look like jeans, but they sure as shit don't feel like it. They're so soft.
Yeah.
And they're stretchy and they're nice. And I bought a pair that just fit right, and they're great. I can't say enough good stuff. And they're not, again, they're not expensive. So if you're in the market for jeans, if you're looking for jeans, I recommend Lee's. I forget what they're called. They're like Stretch Fit or I forget the exact name. I can look them up, but they're so comfortable.
We're living in the golden era of jeans right now. I mean, they've never been better.
I agree.
They've just never been better.
Extreme Motion is the style. Is the Lee's Extreme Motion athletic jeans.
But they're even... I have a pair of dress pants, slacks, if you will.
Ooh, slacks.
And they're even now have like a give to them where you can really kind of stretch in them and, you know, feel good in them. And even those.
Yeah, I think it's brilliant because I feel like manufacturers were like, you know what? America, we're putting on a little weight. Let's make sure we give people something that they're gonna want to wear in case, you know, they want it to be comfortable, and I get it. Sweatpants are one of the most comfortable things. My wife bought me a couple pairs of sweatpants a few months back. The most comfortable things. That I think really kickstarted my... I want to just have more comfortable stuff. My wife bought me two pairs of... She went on vacation. She brought back a couple pairs of sweatpants, and they're the most comfortable sweatpants. And I was like, this is amazing. How can I live the rest of my life like this?
Summer of George. Ease.
Oh yeah. All right. That's my vacation. That's what happened on my vacation. Happened with you in Florida.
What was that? Did you get the wrap up song just now?
I got the let's hear about Florida.
Oh,
that's what we want today.
Yeah, I don't know how. So I don't know if there's anything like too exciting or thrilling, but it was fucking great to just break away from the norm of everyday life. Like you said, like you, when you put on a pair of jeans or you get that new towel and you're like, holy shit, like yeah. This is great. Like when you're just like, oh, I don't have to read for 6 hours today. Like, you know, or just all the things that you do or school and soccer, all this shit. And you're just like, no, we just have to get to the beach today. Like that's
at whatever time.
Yeah. Like that's the goal. That's the objective. It was kind of fucked up because like I got sick, got medicine, started feeling better. And I was like, oh, I'll be better by the time we leave. I wasn't. And then I was like, oh, maybe the first day or two and I should be okay. And I was fucked up the entire, I'm still fucked up, you know, so much so that I went. So we, truth be told, we got back Thursday and I didn't think it was going to be worth it to just do a Friday show. So that was the goal from the beginning. We said we were coming back today, the 28th. And then it just so happened that a friend of ours, something wonderful happened to him. So there was like this impromptu gathering, which I came to. And I don't know if you know. So Frank was there. J-Sabs, we were all kind of there. I don't know if you noticed this, but I just fucking left.
Yeah, I did notice that. You pulled a me. I went into the house for a minute. I came back out and Cuddles was like, yeah, he's gone. He's in the car. He does not feel good. I was like, all right. Yeah, you did. Because you didn't sound good. You sounded like this, only your voice was way worse. So your voice does sound better tonight than it did.
Yeah, because 2 days. And I think it was the traveling back, you know, like the travel day. It was weird. Traveling there, it was fine because we like left really late, which was kind of stupid. But when we came back from Florida, we kind of like had like a really lazy day and the flight wasn't until 6:30, mm-hmm. You know, and you got to like check out of a hotel at like 11, which, okay, here comes a couple of complaints. This is a new thing now where you go, you know, you ask for a late checkout. It's common courtesy for them to give you an hour.
Right.
You know, 11 o'clock checkout's pretty common. You ask for 12. That's nothing, you know, that's nothing out of the norm, out of the realm of possibility. This
which I'm
resort
against
that
anyway.
We were,
I'm against all this anyway, but go ahead. I have my reasons.
This resort that we were in. Well, you know, if they don't have somebody else coming into the room, they could do it for you.
Well, here's my reasoning. Checkout should be midnight of the day you're leaving. And then the room should be worked on, and then people check in the morning if you, you know, the next day.
That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard of.
What do you mean? No, like, so if you're leaving on...
So you can't sleep? You have to wake up at midnight and leave?
No. If you, like, you could leave at 8 p.m., 9 p.m. You don't have to
leave.
You're
saying you get the room
10 o'clock
day.
In the morning. You get the room for the entire day.
Oh, got it. You know, that makes sense.
That's what I'm saying. And then overnight, the room gets cleaned. And then the person who shows up at 8 in the morning checks in.
Mm.
That's the way it should be. I don't like this middle of the day checkout. Because, you know, then you have the whole day. And, you know, you're with your bags. It's such an inconvenience for... It's probably convenient for the hotels, but it's an inconvenience for everybody else,
people.
I think.
Beaver Boys is really making me laugh. Like, I keep putting up his funny comments. Or hers. I don't know. I'm assuming this... I don't know. Is there two people? I don't know how it all works. But they're very funny. So keep it coming, Beaver Boys. So I call and I go, yeah, you know, I lied. I go, I feel like I pushed back a little, you know, cause could we get a late checkout? And there she goes, well, what time? I said, I'd love 12. I said, I'd love 1 o'clock, but I'll settle for 12 if that's what you could do. She comes back. She goes, we could do 1 o'clock for you. Oh, thanks. It'll be $20 an hour for each additional hour plus tax.
After that or with the late checkout?
With the late checkout. Like, meaning if I want to stay till 12, it's $20. If I want to stay till 1, it's $40 plus tax.
But that's not a late checkout. That's adding time to your... Yeah. That's ridiculous.
I was a little pissed about that. And I've seen a couple of people talk about that, but I didn't really think it would happen to me.
I never heard of that till now.
I'm like, that's kind of ridiculous. And she was like, well, that's the... So at first I said, forget it. And I hung up the phone. Then I get a call because the resort that we were at is right on the beach. It was beautiful. There were so many things for the kids to do. Frank, when I tell you, like, there was a huge slide right on the beach, like a water slide. Like, they inflated every day and the kids went down it. They fucking loved it. There were paddle boats where we like rode around their little lake system. And
nice. That's fun. I like that.
It was everything was amazing. We were swimming with fishes. It was just perfect. But there was this little element of like, not nickel and diming, but like I go to the lobby to get a coffee. They have like a bar and they like serve Starbucks coffee. Okay. Guy, I go, my wife loves iced coffee, just black. I go, can I get an iced coffee? He pours the thing in. It's a cashless resort. So I give him the credit card. He runs the credit card. Can you sign for me? I'm like, really? You need me to sign for a $4 iced coffee? And it's got the tip thing on it. And it's like, you just poured an iced coffee for me.
So then don't tip, you know, or tip it, whatever.
I tipped a dollar. I felt like a shithead tipping it. But it was like, it was like little weird things. Like, you go to the deli to get like a sandwich for lunch. And it's like, or no, it wasn't even. Yeah. Oh, I went to the deli to get a drink. And it's like, there's a tip. And it's not like, would you like to leave a tip? It was like 16, 18 or 20%. And I'm like, it's just a first, I'm already paying $3.50 for a fucking Pepsi, you know. Yeah,
that demanded. I don't think tipping has gotten a little out of control.
It's kind of crazy.
I am all for tipping. I'm for over tipping. I'm for tipping like crazy.
I believe in over tipping.
Yeah, but like when nothing has been done that you know that warrants tipping, then there shouldn't be tipping expected. You know, like everything can't be tipped.
It's just you feel bad because some of them work for, like, some of them are like, hey, how are you?
Oh, how's absolutely. Your day? If their job depends on tips, I get that.
No, but even the girl behind the counter for the Pepsi was like, how are you? Is everything okay with your steak? And I do. And I'm like,
all right. That's the thing. If anybody goes above and beyond, you throw them a little. I get that. You know, that's fine.
But I was a little like, so.
Yeah.
We get there. We check in and, you know, they're like, you want to go on the tour of the property. So as I go to find out, like, not only is it a beautiful beachside resort, but it's a timeshare thing. And they're like, you want to go for the thing? And I'm like, not overly, no. And they're like, well, if you change your mind, I'm like, okay. And then we check into the room and then like 20 minutes, we're in the room, half hour in the room. The woman calls us. You know, I do have a spot for tomorrow. And I'm like, okay, this is getting a little, you know. Little much. So anyway, fast forward to the end. I asked for the late checkout. She says it's money. I say, forget it. Get a call from the woman. She's like, we have this thing. You can come back and stay for only like, now that the hotel was like five something a night, $450, whatever it was a night. So they're like, you can come back and stay for like 4 days for just $299. If you come back and you take the tour. So I say to the woman, I go, actually, I'll never stay here ever again because you want to charge me $20 extra for fucking...
You said that?
Yeah. I said that. Yeah. I said I asked for a late checkout and they wanted $20 more out of me, so I'm never coming back here again.
Man.
So she goes, well, that's common in all of... We were in St. Pete's Beach. She goes, that's common in all of St. Pete's Beach. And I'm like, now I feel like George Costanza because I'm like, is it? Because I feel like I'm going to call some hotel.
Oh, do it.
I haven't yet. Them. But I think, I don't know how I could go into October without having called some other hotels.
You're never going to call them.
I might not. I don't know. But I was really annoyed by that. But anyway, I was sitting there with my wife. And we're like, what the fuck are we going to do? So we called back up and we're like, all right, we'll pay $40 to stay here. Till 1 o'clock.
They got you.
Totally got us.
That sucks.
Just totally got us. So that was a little irritating. That was like the end of the trip. Because how we did it was we went to Orlando. We did Universal Studios, then we went by my parents, and then we did the beach, you know, we went and visited my parents for a couple of days down in Florida. So we fly there, and we were flying on Frontier because where we live here on Long Island, we do have this like little tiny airport that is so peaceful and wonderful. Have you ever flown out of MacArthur?
No.
MacArthur Airport is like the size of a house. Like, it's so tiny, and it has like two airlines. It's Southwest or Frontier. So it's like not grand whatsoever. But the airfare is very expensive, very inexpensive and affordable. But more than that, Frank and I grew up in the shadow of JFK Airport. So we're used to like 3-hour waiting lines and just congestion and annoyance and all this shit. So to fly out of MacArthur is like such a pleasure. So we fly out of MacArthur, but it's Frontier, which is such a shit airline. Like, it is just shit. And we get there, and you know, we have one suitcase, and you can fill that suitcase. It's 50, it's a 50 pound suitcase. Like, it's the standard size roller suitcase, yeah. 50 pounds. Yeah. You get there, and the girl goes, suitcase is overweight. And I go, how much? She's like, 16 pounds. And I go, what? Turns out they changed the weight limit to 40 pounds.
Bastards.
Which is such a shitty thing, because
so you'd still be 6 pounds over.
I would have still been 6 pounds over, which is not the worst thing in the world, but like, you just, the standard size of a suitcase holds 50 pounds.
Yeah. You can't just change the rules and have, we all have these suitcases. Yeah. Now you're changing the rules. Well, then we got to get all new suitcases.
So they hit me up for $75.
Fuck, man. Everywhere just nickels and dimes you just to death. It's just these little jabs that just bleed you dry.
Yeah, but listen, I don't complain, because I think we literally paid like $39 for the ticket. I mean, it's like ridiculous.
So did you have to help fly at one point?
You got to push the airplane away from the terminal.
Okay.
So we get on the plane, or flying, and it's nighttime now because the flight leaves at like 7. It was delayed a little, whatever. So we're flying into Orlando. They darken all the lights on the cabin. Half hour goes by, the lights come on, every light, like bright as hell. Then the stewardess gets on and goes, is there any medical professionals on the airplane? So I look around and nobody gets up, and I go, this ain't American Airlines or Delta. There's no fucking doctors buying a seat on fucking Frontier. You know, nobody gets up.
That's funny.
So now I'm like, fuck, we're going to probably wind up landing in Georgia or some shit because some guy's having a heart attack.
Yeah, why does everything bad happen to you?
Right. So, turns out we go to find out it was a veteran who was having a difficulty breathing. But we make it all the way to Florida. And the only reason why I know this is because, like, we land in Florida and they go, please, everybody stay seated. We still don't have a gate. So we're on the ground. They're like, we don't have a gate to go to. And even when we get a gate, we want to get... The stewardess was lovely. She goes, this handsome young veteran off the plane. It was an old guy. So within 3 seconds of her saying that, half the plane is standing up, and it's like in the aisle. Just assholes. So then we finally get a gate, and the plane goes pitch black. All the lights go off. So now I didn't know if the pilot was just like, I'm turning the lights off. Fuck these people.
Fuck these people.
We get to the thing. The lights never come back on. The stewardesses are all standing holding flashlights because the plane blew a fuse.
Oh, my God.
Lost all power. Yep.
What the hell is that?
So that wasn't even the worst part. And if you've ever been to Orlando, the only airport in the United States shittier than JFK is Orlando, because it's way too small for the amount of flights that are coming in there.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just terrible. So we get there. It's one flight, Frank. One flight. It's around, I don't even know, I should ask my wife, 10:30 maybe, 11 o'clock by the time we land. And they announce that we're on carousel 9. Okay, go down. Turns out we're on carousel 7, 9, and 11. So 3 carousels in a row for one flight. Bags are going around. So now we took our luggage and we took the kids' booster seats for the cars and everything. You can throw that. That's not, that doesn't count as a piece. You could just take that shit. So, and you know, you can take a stroller or whatever. We didn't, but other people did, obviously. And so we're standing there and the bags are going around. And then all of a sudden I see my bag, I grab it. And then the little baggage thing stops, thing beeps, right? All right. Standing around 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 5 minutes. Okay. Well, who's going to, like, we got to say something, like, it's not coming back on. The office for Frontier is like 10 feet away, 20 feet away. I walk over there. I go, you know, the thing has stopped. They know about it. Okay, fine. Which makes sense, because if you're on the other side, and I worked at an airport, yeah, there's just the same baggage thing on the other side. Like, it just keeps going. Just
loading it up, yeah.
So if it stops, they see it. 10 minutes later, two other people go in, complain. Woman comes out. Now she's removing the bags from the back row. So we're thinking, okay, that she's removing the thing so that it could go.
Yeah.
You know, that's what everybody's thinking. Because all the people that are waiting there, which is about 50 people, are waiting for more things. This one woman's got this kid and he starts crying because it's 11 o'clock at night. Kid's exhausted. He's crying. She's holding him. She's waiting for the stroller to come out. We were there for about 45 minutes. I finally go into the thing and I go, what is going on? She goes, all the bags are out. I go, no, they're not, because there's 50 people waiting over there and I'm waiting for two car seats. This woman's waiting for a stroller. Oh no, the oversized items are on the other side of that scaffolding wall that they're doing construction for. They came out of carousel 13.
Well, when were they going to say anything?
I go, when were you going to say that? We made an announcement. No, you didn't, because we came right down here. And if you made an announcement, there would not be 50 fucking people. I literally cursed at her because I was so fucking annoyed that we were all just standing. So sure enough, I go around. Frank, when I tell you a pile, no one grabbed anything from this pile because nobody fucking knew it was there.
So how did you have to go to everybody and say, it's over here, everyone?
I grabbed my shit. I go, all the stuff is over there, loud as hell. And the woman with the baby was like, I don't fucking believe this. And she was like, I don't know what she did to that fucking lady. I think she might have, because at least my kids, and you know, Cuddles.
They don't see people standing there?
They don't give a shit.
Like, what? Obviously, you said the thing was 10 feet away. Like, she doesn't see 50 people standing there at an empty thing? Waiting? Like, what do you think they're waiting for?
They don't fucking care.
Oh, my God.
I was going nuts.
All the baggage was out.
They were the lost baggage. So they've been getting bitched at all day long.
Oh, lost baggage. Got to be a nightmare.
Yeah, that's what they were dealing with mostly. But, you know, so. And then, but dude, at one point, a guy comes in. Like, you know, he's got the badge. I'm like, oh, you here to fix this? He literally was like this to me. I go, oh, you're on the. He's like, he wasn't on the. He's just like, I am not talking to you, and this is not my problem. Like, that was his fucking response. To like,
yeah,
I'm not helping you. Yeah,
no good.
So it was like fucking. Ridiculous. It was like midnight before we rolled in, and the next day we were doing Universal Studios with the kids. So it was like
Universal Studios is a trek without kids. I can't imagine.
And hot
with two kids.
Dude, so we get to Universal Studios and my wife is like, you're sweating through your shirt. I go, it's 110 degrees. Yeah. Like, and the humidity is the same. Like, what do you expect? Like, we're fucking. So, and she's got the boot, you know?
Yeah.
So in the airport, she was on in a wheelchair. We got the little scooter for her in Universal Studios. I sent it. I don't know if you saw it in the group chat. I did 3x my normal step goal for Universal with 16,000 steps.
That's a lot of steps.
I walked 8 miles. Cuddles was in the scooter. So she scooted
about
most.
Eminem did.
What? Oh, see. 8 miles. Cuddles was in a scooter and she still walked 3 miles in that day.
It's a big area. not all, you know, if it were me, if I owned Disneyland, I don't know how much it would cost to move that thing a little further north, but.
What, Universal?
The whole thing.
Oh, Disney, the whole thing?
Universal, everything. Just move it. Move it to a northern state.
So originally we were like, so we had two days in Orlando and then a couple days by my parents and then 4 or 5 days at the beach. So we were doing Universal and the idea was we might do a Disney park the second day. If we didn't do a Disney park, we were going to go to maybe a Disney hotel and go see like the animals at Animal Kingdom Lodge. Mm-hmm. Or we were going to go to Disney Springs. The park was out, I think around 11:30 in the morning at Universal, the Disney park the next day was out already. Because we were like, there's no way we could do two parks. There's no way. And then we were like, we'll go to Disney Springs and walk around then. And we were like planning like 4 or 5 hours in Disney Springs. I don't think we lasted 2.5 hours there.
What is Disney Springs?
Disney Springs is like all the stores and the restaurants. It's not like a park, but there's a couple of little attractions to do. No, it's like it was downtown. You remember downtown Disney?
Vaguely.
It's like it's just restaurants and Disney stores and things like that. You know, right. It's a little like the Disney magic, but there's no rides really. There's a couple of little attractions that you could do, there's like an air balloon and shit, you could ride on the lake in a car or that kind of stuff, but nothing major. So okay. We did that and we lasted like 2.5 hours before we were like, let's fucking go. Like we couldn't
get the hell out of here.
Couldn't be done anymore. Couldn't walk around. Couldn't do shit.
Dude, you're in Florida in August. It's going to be 100 million degrees, especially yeah. Nowadays with the hottest summer on record or whatever.
And then we go to my parents, nothing really to tell there other than we go on one of those airboat rides.
Airboat ride.
Yeah, that was pretty cool. We went into like the swamp,
like through the Everglades and shit.
Yep.
Dude, that's a story.
Fucking guy walks in, right? We pay for the thing. They're like, you want to hold the alligator? So the first they tell us, no bug spray. Alligators don't like bug spray. So we're like, okay.
God forbid we disappoint the poor alligator.
Yeah, we're just like, we're just getting eaten alive then. And so we show up and they're like holding like an alligator. Like you can hold an alligator. They got like the mouth taped and everything. It's like this baby alligator, but it's huge.
Yeah.
So it turns out like you hold it after the ride. And we were there like early. And we didn't realize because there was like people going. So we were just kind of like standing there waiting. And they're like, oh, no, they'll let you do this after. The guy was like, we're ready to go. We're like, all right. So we hop on the boat. Guy, we have no teeth, just no teeth in his mouth. Just nothing. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, this is going to be an amazing. This is going to be great. Like
this is who you want to lead your alligator tour.
Yeah.
100%.
And he's like, this guy was fucking ripping through the swamplands and just like making hockey like stops.
Your parents were on this thing?
Oh yeah, where the whole crew went.
I can't see your mom and dad doing that kind of craziness on an airboat.
Well, especially my mother was a little concerned because she's got back problems right now.
Sure.
And you know, she was like, "Is it going to be bumpy?" And they were like, "Nope, it is. It's going to be like riding on a cloud." And they were not lying because it was smooth sailing the whole entire time, and it was like the most beautiful. Like, here, I'll just show you.
Wild alligators out there.
We saw a bunch of alligators, a lot of baby alligators. Actually, probably put this on for everybody. You can kind of see. As going through some swamp, but look at how beautiful this lake was too. Oh,
it's like glass.
Yeah, yeah.
That's smooth.
And this guy, he was flying through these areas. But there was a couple of times where we would go into like some swamp area, yeah. and he would just be like gunning, like you know when you don't see the opening. It was like the Batmobile in the first Batman. Like you can't see the opening, but he knows where it is. You know,
that's crazy.
He would go flying through there. And at one point there was like a little like marsh of leaves and whatever. And there was nothing else around it. And he barreled right towards it. Cause he knew like the leaves and everything were going to fly and hit us all in the face. And he went right fucking for it. But this guy was a crazy son of a bitch. He goes, so we're looking like we would go into these little swampy areas and whatever. And it was weird because the water was actually clear. You could see right to the bottom. And he goes, oh, there's a snake in the tree. And I'm like, right away, I'm like,
like where?
Yeah. This guy thing. Walked right up to the fucking thing and smacked the snake on the ass.
What? My what son, kind of like a huge snake?
It was big. My son started freaking out. He was like, he didn't like, he got scared. But he was like, no, he's very laid back. Like, you know, you, this guy, and he said it in his story, but he, it was apparent. This guy fucking, he was maybe in his 50s. It, yeah. All 50 years of his life were spent on this fucking, in this area.
Yeah. This guy knew his shit.
He knew his shit. I think I have a picture of the snake, but I like 90 pictures. So it'll be hard to find.
Yeah. Well, a snake in a pet store that big is scary. Never mind a snake in the middle of the wilderness, in the middle of the Everglades. You don't know
right.
if they just ate or not, or if they're hungry or whatever the hell they're doing. I mean, this right. guy I'm sure knows. You could probably tell just by looking at it.
I should have probably like downloaded these pictures, but if you could see on the back of his jacket, it says Gator Bait.
It does.
And then, so I'll zoom in a little bit here, but you could see the fan and like on the branch, I don't know if you could see it, but that dark thing right there is the snake.
Oof. That's a big boy.
It was pretty big.
And he slapped it on the, whatever.
He slapped it and it did not move. It did not
probably
move.
Could tell. He could probably tell, because if they just ate, he probably could tell they were pretty, I'm no expert, but from what I understand, if they just ate, then they're pretty docile and they're like just digesting. Or if they're asleep, I don't know. So he probably could tell that this snake is probably just going to be fine. Or it's probably a harmless kind of a, yeah, there you go.
Like, I don't know if you could tell,
that's
but
nice.
He's just whipping around, like just whipping around. And it was more like you'll see in a second that like he's just, see these ways he's just taking the yeah. turns.
There's like no waves at all. Yeah, that's a smooth ride.
It was beautiful. But there was a, like here, you'll see in a second, there was like a hawk or something or an eagle or some shit like flying right next to us.
Hello.
Yeah.
Cool.
It was just beautiful. You know us. We're from fucking Queens. We're not nature people. Like this was the fucking.
Yeah, we got raccoons and possums. That's our
it.
Nature.
Yeah,
that's
our
wildlife.
But yeah, it was beautiful. And then we went by my parents who live in the Villages in Florida, which is the swinger capital of the world. So
there you go. You know, how did they do? They get a few phone numbers?
Well, I it's funny because I mentioned this one day, like my mother has pineapples on everything. And I was like, oh my God, I think it's, yeah.
Yep.
As it turns out, it's palm trees, not pineapples. I misremembered it.
Get out of here. No, wait yeah. a minute. That, because that's not just you. That's a big thing, right? The pineapple, isn't that universally a thing?
The pineapple is the swinger thing. I thought she had like pillows with pineapples on it. But the pillows have palm trees on it. Like I was like, oh, thank God.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean they're not, you know, taking in the scenery.
But we go, like, they have these, like, town squares where they have, like, drinks and everything. So we're going to get drinks. And these people were just fucking fucked up and high and drunk.
Aaron's thing. So the only thing that scared this guy was a toothbrush.
Yeah, basically. Basically.
That's funny.
I'm trying to see if I have. Oh yeah, this was great. So this was us in the Villages. They have these like bands that like play and everything, you know.
Yeah.
And they and like here, this is just kind of like, look at this one dude who's just, look at this guy high off his ass just fucking dancing. Look at him.
This guy's just enjoying life, man.
Just having a fucking time. People Einstein? Are dancing. Huh?
It looks like Einstein.
It did kind of look like Einstein. But they were like, we got to see like the whip, like the people are like. Just everybody's walking around DTF down to fuck. They're just like,
dude.
We were joking with Janine. She could clean up on old man down there.
That it's like Thanksgiving down there for her. She just get the pick of the all the vittles are right there for her.
Yeah. Yeah. So but now I got this thing where I can't fucking breathe. So we go to the beach and there's the fucking this 50-foot, you know, slide.
Okay.
And so my son's like, come on, you got to go on the slide. You got to go on the slide. I go, all right. So I go to start. I go to the guy. So he goes on the slide. I go to the guy. You know, I'm 200-something pounds. Can I go on the slide? I go, yeah. So I'm like, all right. So They hose you down so you're not sandy, you know, because you're walking right off the beach. I climb up the fucking thing. By the time I get to the top, I literally thought I was going to die. I thought I was going to die.
How high of a thing is it?
Dude, feet? It was such a steep.
Do you have a picture?
Yeah.
I got to see this thing.
Here's a picture of it.
Oh, that's not that high.
Dude, look at the
that's
hotel.
Like 20 feet up, 20, 30 feet up.
No, look at the hotel. Look at the person to the left.
The person is what, 6 feet tall, let's say. Add another 4 feet. That's 10. Yeah, that's like a 20, 25 foot climb.
Yeah, I'm telling you, it was. I almost died. I got up to the top and I'm like, I can't fuck it. The guy's looking at me. He's like, are you okay? I go, I don't know.
Well, not to mention the fact that it's 120 degrees there. I mean, that's not going to help you.
So I go down. I go down it and I'm like, oh, great. It's nice. It's fun. So then my daughter goes down. She doesn't really like it. But my son is so excited to go. She's like, Dad, can you go with me? So now I'm like, I don't know if I can do
this. Nope. Yeah, let the stranger take it. It'll be fun. Go ahead.
Yeah. So she gets me and she gets my wife to go. So now we're going up, right? My daughter's going up next to me. I'm going up and my wife is behind us.
She was able to climb up the thing with her foot?
It took her a while.
Right.
Because she has to keep her foot like this, you know, like she, yeah. It's the flex and whatever. But on the way you go up the slide, you kind of can do it, you know?
All right.
So we go up. Now I'm, this is the second time in like 20, you know, 10 minutes I'm doing it. I'm dying. So I go to my daughter. I go, you go on that one. I'll go on this one and we'll race down. And she goes, no, I want to go with you. And I go, yeah, I don't think you can do that. And there's like a fucking 16-year-old kid. He goes, no, you can do it. And I'm like,
thanks, buddy.
Are you sure? And he's like, yeah, it'll be fine.
It's Florida. So, you can do whatever you want.
Yeah, that was literally it. So I grab her and we're going down now. And I don't know what we hit, like a dry spot on the way down. But instead of going feet down, we totally spin. And we are now like head first going down. And so we wind up here. And now I'm trying to laugh because if you laugh, she feels like it's fine and it's safe. Right. But I can't laugh because I'm coughing. My brain's out. And
so you end up traumatizing.
And she's like, I didn't like it. And she's starting to cry. And there's just water in my face. So I clear the water in my face just enough to see my wife start to come down the same thing that we've come down. And it's the closest to like a stunt movie I've ever been in. Because I literally had to grab my daughter and jump out of the way or else my wife would have taken us the fuck out. And I tell, she doesn't even realize this because we were talking about it afterwards. Because when I took CC down, I was holding her. So we were sitting up. So we didn't go that far down once we landed. But my wife was laying down all the way. So she gained
she
all
the bottom.
And she was flying. She went flying past us. And she didn't even see me grab her and go jump out of the way. The most heroic moment of my life. Literally nobody saw.
Nobody caught it.
Yeah.
Nobody's. That would have been nice. But nope. Like it didn't happen.
Yeah.
At least your daughter will remember it. Maybe.
Yeah. It's, you know, so it's funny about that. We spent $650 to get into Universal Studios. Probably $1,000 by the time food and all that shit. Hotels, another $500, whatever. Every ride we went on, she's like, I didn't like that. She's like, that was too scary.
But she kept going on each ride, though.
She kept going on each ride. She was a trooper.
That's good.
She kept going on each ride, but every ride we got off, she was like, yeah. Two rides, she didn't mind. The Minions, obviously, she loved that.
Okay.
And then Jimmy Fallon's Escape from New York or whatever the fuck it's called. She liked that because
Jimmy Fallon has a ride in fucking Universal.
Oh, yeah.
What is going on?
They have a whole building that looks like Rockefeller Center. And it's in there.
Rockefeller Center.
Let me tell you something.
You can stand outside and smoke, too. It's great.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, but let me tell you, dude, when we were driving to the fucking boat thing.
Yeah.
Wasn't nobody around that voted for Joe Biden in that fucking area. Let me tell you something.
There's a shock.
my wife goes passing these houses, and she's like, it's just like cars and ATVs and shit just all over the lawn. I'm like, they don't give a fuck. Like, nobody comes by here, you know?
Right, right.
And even the tour guide, like, you know, it's funny.
How'd you find this crocodile place? Just Google it?
Just Google it. There's only two, you know. This one was one that had a better website.
Okay.
That was it. The other one was like TJ and Larry's, and this one was like Alligator Adventures. I'm like, at least, I don't know, they named it. They got a site. I feel like they tried, you know?
That sounds good. I'd go by that.
Yeah. But even like the guy who took us on the tour, like, you understand, you do, you understand the Republican, like this guy's life, like, you know, we work and we're like, let's go take trips and let's see places. This guy doesn't fucking think that way. You know, like he thinks, leave me the fuck alone. Like, yeah, I want to ride my boat. And I want to
know with that. That's a great life.
Hunt my animals. And, you know, he's never going to go 10 miles past where he was born.
Nothing wrong with that.
Nothing wrong with it at all.
He's a happy guy.
But you understand why they're kind of like, I don't want anybody to come in here and tell me I can't be drunk off my ass driving my ATV hunting alligator. You know, you're like, all right, I guess
who's
so.
Who's telling him not to do that?
No, I'm just, you know, it's.
I'm not telling him not to do that. It's a wonderful thing to ride your airboat, fanboat, whatever the hell.
I'm just saying, like, when we're like, we think of it from a New York City mentality of like, I don't know about having guns around here. It's just too many people. We're down there. They're like, don't take my fucking gun away from me because I might need it to kill an alligator.
I get that, but that's a whole different thought. But yeah, you can have your guns. No one's taking any guns away.
But I'm saying, like, their world is completely different from our world.
Oh, of course it is. Yeah, it's a different... Well, it's a different landscape. It's a different area of the world. It's
like
it may be the same country, but it's a different part of the world.
You look at your thing and you got your manicured lawns and your yard and your fence. It's so nice. And they just have like shit everywhere. And it's like they don't care what it looks like. They want to have fun. They want to jump on an ATV and have an adventure. And when that one stops working, they leave it there because the new one might need parts one day. And so they'll get it off the old one that don't work anymore.
Living the life. Nothing wrong with it. Doesn't hurt anybody. Who cares?
Yeah, that's the way they are. So it's like you kind of start to understand, like, oh, I get it. I get that mentality is there. They live in a different, it's the same country.
Right.
But it's a different planet.
Yeah, I hear you.
You know, so.
All right,
we've done too much time.
Yeah, good vacations all around.
Yeah.
Well, we're happy to be back.
I don't know if I'm going to survive this cough. I can't.
Dude.
And then people go, how are you feeling? And I don't even know how to, I'm like, fuck, same. So I go back to the doctor, gives me an antibiotic, steroids, and an inhaler, which supposedly is also a steroid, I just learned.
That's good.
I'm 3 days into this, and I'm still fucking coughing my fucking face off. I don't know.
Did he say how long this will take to go away? What
said
it
you
is?
Should feel Does better.
He know what it is?
He said you should feel better in a few days. Okay. I don't know.
Does he at least tell you? Oh, this is what it is. Is it like a respiratory infection, a viral? What do we know? What it is?
So the first lady doctor I saw, who gave me cough medicine, that really didn't work, and don't really care for her. Second guy I saw, James, good dude. Second time I saw him, he saved my life previously. He was like, he didn't say this, but the feeling was, we're just going to throw a bunch of shit at this and see what happens, you know?
Right.
So I think that's kind of what we're going for. Oh, but Friday, we're outside and I'm like, I'm cold. Is anybody else cold? I think you were like, no. And I was like,
yeah, no, I was not cold. It was comfortable that night. And you said that you were cold. That's not a good sign.
I whispered to my wife, I go, I will be in the car. Like, I couldn't even bear with saying goodbye to everybody.
Yeah.
I got home, 102 temperature.
That's good.
And I was like, I'm going to go to the doctor tomorrow. I'm like, I got to go back and get some shit for this.
Yeah, you were all fucked up.
I was fucked up. Like, people were talking, and I started, like, I was just like, I think I said to our friend who we were celebrating, his wife, I saw her on the way out, and I go, I don't want to be rude. I was like, but I have to leave. I'm like, this was wonderful and thank you. And I walked out the fucking front door and didn't say two words to anybody else and just waited in the car.
Dude, you gotta do what you gotta do. You don't have to, you know, your wife, as soon as when I saw her, she's like, Anthony's in the car, doesn't feel good. She explained to everybody, you're fine, don't worry about it.
Because you don't know what it's like. Because I said to my daughter, I go, get your shoes, we're going to go. 10 minutes later, she comes back, still no shoes. I go, where are your shoes?
Oh, yeah,
shoes?
We were, my wife and I were, and your wife were looking for shoes all over.
Are you furious? Are you really serious?
We were, yeah.
I'm sorry.
We knew you guys were getting ready to leave, but we couldn't find a shoe. They were like upstairs, and like in some room.
She goes, I don't know where my shoes are. And that was the moment where I said to my wife, I go, I will be in the car.
Yeah, I can't handle this right now.
I don't know how long it's going to take you to do, but I will be in the car. And I was like, because I'm like, I really felt like I'm going to pass out. So if I just pass out, like, let me just sleep it off in the car. You guys can stay and have fun. And whenever you're done, you come get me, wake me up, and we'll fucking go home, you know?
Dude, get yourself better because, you know.
People say, and then my mother's calling me every 5 minutes, and then she's like, are you doing that? I go, I got steroids and antibiotics now. I don't know if putting my head over the fucking steam thing is going to work anymore, you know? Like, it I did that you. 6 times already.
Oh, you've done that, okay.
Yeah, I was doing it. It helps, you know, for the moment, and then, you know.
Yeah. Even if you take, like, a hot shower and you get the steam, you start breathing in the steam.
Yeah, yeah.
That'll help a little.
I got to do it.
Clears your sinuses kind of thing. Helps your throat.
I didn't mean to do 2 hours with you here, Frank, but I'm sorry. I know you're...
That's all right. It's a show back. You know, it's a nice way to spend the show.
Yes, it was. It was, and it's so good to see everybody in the live chat again. My goodness.
Yes.
Oh, my.
Glad to be back.
The messages, I shared a couple with you of the people that were like, this is ridiculous. They're like, 2 weeks.
Yeah.
It was very flattering.
It was long, and we appreciate the support, and we're happy to be back.
Yes.
Take your shirt. Beaver Boys is not going to stop until you take your shirt, which is, this Beaver Boys isn't, if you go up a little bit, he's from Florida, so maybe you saw him down there.
Maybe I did. Florida is the New Jersey of the South. It sure is, man.
Maybe Beaver Boys led the alligator hunt.
He might have.
Was that the guy?
He might have been the guy. I don't know. This is a great idea from Bird. If Ant dies, we should add a tombstone hoodie to the AOA merch.
Always thinking, Bird. I love it.
That would be great.
Dude, get yourself to bed. Feel better.
Thank you. I will. I appreciate everybody. Of course, we're back. Like I said, J-Sabs is actually on vacation. And Frankie is going to be on vacation, but we're back to the regular schedule for the most part. So we'll be here in some way, shape, or form or another.
Agreed.
Which will be nice.
Glad to be back. We got merch in the store. Go pick up that merch. We got
the Oval Aaron's book is still available.
Oval is still available on Amazon. You can pick that up, either the ebook, you know, the Kindle version, or the regular hard copy. Still available.
Link is in the description for sure. I don't know why this comment got held, but Bird, a member for 17 months.
That's commitment. We appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Appreciate that wholeheartedly. Thank you so much, Bird.
Yes.
Really, really appreciate that. Thank you for that. Yes. All right. That's it for us. We'll be back Wednesday, normal time. Like Frankie C said, all the links are in the thing and the thing and the links.
And get your thing and go through the thing.
And that'll be it. If I live to survive, I should say, if I've survived to Wednesday, we'll see you guys on Wednesday. That'll be the thing.
God willing. We'll see. Fingers crossed.
Show me potato salad.
Maybe we should go now.
Go ahead.